Good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have apologies from Deputy Convener Michael Mara, whose substitute today is former committee stalwart Daniel Johnson. And welcome back to the committee today. The first item on our agenda is to take evidence from the Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity on the Circular Economy Scotland Bill Financial Memorandum. And I intend to allow up to 75 minutes for this evidence session. The Minister is joined today by Scottish Government officials, Ginny Gardner, Head of Circular Economy Unit, Janet McVeigh, Head of Zero Waste Unit, Alexander Quayle, Team Leader, Recycling, and Gareth Heavisides, Circular Economy Team Leader. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting and invite the Minister to make a short opening statement. Minister.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity to speak with you today. The Circular Economy Bill will establish the legislative framework to support Scotland's transition to a zero waste and circular economy, significantly increase reuse and recycling rates, and modernise and improve waste and recycling services. The bill takes powers to give ministers and local authorities the tools they need to achieve our ambitions for a circular economy. These represent a package of new powers and responsibilities that will be underpinned by support and investment, such as the £70 million Recycling Improvement Fund. This builds on over £1 billion of funding provided through the former Strategic Waste Fund between 2008 and 2022 to assist local authorities in the implementation of a zero waste plan. At the heart of many of the provisions in this bill is the recognition that co-design, based on the principles of the Verity House Agreement and the New Deal for Business, will be central to delivering the transformation that we need to see. Regulations made under these enabling powers in the bill will be subject to further consultation, parliamentary scrutiny, and impact assessments, including business regulatory impact assessments. As a result, the financial memorandum provides strategic level cost and benefit data. This will be refined as part of ongoing work with local authorities and householders, businesses, and other stakeholders through, for example, the development of the waste route map. The bill is necessarily narrow in the topics that it covers. It sits in the space where the Scottish Government needs new powers to take action, between powers which are reserved and matters which are devolved where we have already taken powers. Legislation is, of course, only part of the solution. A wide range of other measures are in train. Alongside the Circular Economy Bill, we are developing our Circular Economy and Waste Route Map, which will provide strategic direction for how we will deliver our system-wide, comprehensive vision for sustainable resource use and Scotland's circular economy to 2030. An updated draft route map will be published later in 2023 for further consultation and will be finalised in 2024. Extended producer responsibility for packaging, which we are introducing alongside other UK governments, will require producers to pay local authorities the full net cost of operating an efficient and effective household packaging collection service. This will provide substantial funding to local authorities, estimated at £1.2 billion per annum across the UK. Let me finish by underlining that building a more circular economy is an environmental imperative, but it is also an economic opportunity for Scotland. It opens up new market opportunities, improves productivity, increases self-sufficiency, and provides local employment opportunities. Thank you, and I'm looking forward to answering your questions.
Thank you very much for that very helpful opening statement. I've already scribbled down a huge number of notes from the comments that you've actually made. Of course, it would help if I could read my writing. That might make life a little bit easier. But first of all, I'm going to just start by referring to some of the evidence that we received in a couple of weeks, and you'll obviously be familiar with that. And in terms of the evidence we took, which was from the local authorities of Dundee, South Lanarkshire and West Lothian, I think it's fair to say that they are not enamoured, not so much with the direction of travel. I think in terms of policy, they're definitely on board. But it's the issue that this committee obviously is concerned about, and that's finance, obviously, and how this will be funded. So, for example, the first person to give evidence was Dundee City Council. In their opening comment, the first thing they said was that there's insufficient financial detail, that the £70 million that was referred to is not sufficient for all of Scotland. that the finances that are being made available don't take into account the real cost of running these particular infrastructure facilities, and indeed additional facilities and additional resources will be required to actually manage those facilities, and that's not being taken into account. I went on to say that the Dundee went on to say that their view is that the costs are underestimated to the tune of about 50%, i.e. the £70 million should be more like £140 million. So how would you respond to those concerns?
Thank you very much, Convener. I absolutely understand that councils have concerns around future planning. We're all looking ahead and knowing that budgets are tight and knowing that we need to make this just transition to net zero. In response to that, the main point, I think, with this bill is that this is very much a framework bill. This is the start of a journey for us to go on, to bring our recycling rates and our reuse rates up to the levels that we know we can and that we need to do for net zero. Convener, you're absolutely correct. Councils are on board with the journey we need to go on. And we have committed, I've committed in writing, and again through the Verity House process, to co-designing with councils. So each of the provisions in this bill then will have underneath of it detailed policies to be brought forward. For example, on the single-use charges for single-use items. At this time, we're looking at an enabling framework to allow the Scottish Government and the Parliament to bring forward this kind of legislation. But exactly what items, how they would be managed, exactly how those charges would be collected and implemented, exactly what benefits and savings for litter and waste management those would bring to local authorities are to be developed in detail with local authorities as we move forward. And as the recent discussions about, for example, single-use vapes have brought to our attention, these matters can come up quite quickly, and they need to be handled quite urgently. So we cannot see down the line exactly all the different ways that this framework may be used. What we have got today is the costs for strategically looking at the framework and some indicative costs of some of the initial policies that we intend to bring forward with this framework.
But of course, local authorities, want to be able to plan ahead. I mean, we produced a report just last week talking about the importance of forward planning. They feel, and certainly the evidence they gave to us, which you'll be aware of, they don't feel they can do that if they don't have commitments in terms of the resources that they require will be made available. And their view is that, I mean, co-design, and I quote from Kirsten McGuire of South Lanarkshire, is where we want to be, close quotes. But there has to be the resources to actually deliver that. And she, among the others who are giving evidence, just said, well, I'm sorry, the money just isn't going to be there to deliver this. So, for example, if you look at enforcement officers, the costs that are in the financial memorandum relative to what she thinks are the real costs are only about half what they suggested the real cost of enforcement would be. In terms of things like the littering fines, the suggestion in the financial memorandum that 100% of these will be collected bears no resemblance to the 10-15% they think will actually be collected based on their own experience. And indeed, through fiscal fines, local authorities get nothing back at all. So how do you address the points that were made 2 weeks ago by our witnesses in terms of some of these very cogent issues?
Absolutely. I absolutely understand that both businesses and local authorities need certainty going forward. That is why we've committed to that co-design process. And of course, I cannot second guess what the outcome of that process may be, but these would be developed over many months following that co-design process, after which they would have the opportunity to come through Parliament, whether that's through an SSI affirmative procedure or a negative procedure, so that they can have scrutiny. So there would be, for each specific policy that would be brought forward, all those details would be worked through and developed with the councils, with businesses, and indeed with householders, so that there would be clarity for each particular policy as that comes through. We would definitely will be working with the councils to deliver those outcomes. This isn't something that's going to be imposed centrally. As for the enforcement cost, as we go through the financial memorandum in detail, we can look at which of these provisions allow councils to increase their fixed penalty notices, for example, so that it gives councils more opportunities to balance out their costs. But all of the enforcement costs, particularly for local authorities, is at the discretion of the local authority as to how much they wish to spend on enforcement versus the benefits they might receive from that enforcement. For example, on the household requirements for waste, that is around contamination of the recycling stream. These powers that this bill would allow is for the councils to use should they decide to do that. There's no requirement for them to enforce in any particular way, but they may decide that their recyclate is becoming so contaminated that they are losing money because they are then having to pay for that to go to incineration, or they're having to pay for it to go to landfill, or they're not able to sell that recyclate at its full value. And so the money that they are losing would make it worth their while to enforce more firmly. But that is entirely a calculation for local authorities to make the decision on.
But they can't actually take those decisions if they haven't got the resources to actually implement it, regardless of what they may wish to do. And I think what they're actually saying to us is, look, we actually want to do what the government suggests, but you can't squeeze a quarter of a pint into a pint pot. The bottom line is the resources are not being made. So, I mean, will the Scottish Government fully fund this bill, I think, is it in a nutshell?
The outcomes of this bill, so this bill is a framework bill, and this bill allows us to start the journey, for example, down the route of things like imposing charges on single-use plastics. I cannot predict all the items down the line that this Parliament and government may wish to impose those charges on, in terms of getting industry to report on the waste that they want, that they are producing, and the surpluses that they're producing. We're looking at starting with food waste, but down the line, this Parliament may choose to look at other sectors and industries. So this bill is the start of a journey, and each of these provisions provides for taking specific policy actions down the line in line with councils.
Hold on a second. But if you're taking actions, they have to be, the costings have to be realistic. And the point is, the local government is saying that the costings are not realistic. So therefore, even if they agree to take things forward to the nth degree, which is really what they want to do. I mean, nobody wants to have contaminated waste. Everyone wants to maximise recycling. That's a given right across the Parliament. But it has to be fundable. And one of the things that, because each local authority is different, Dundee, for example, talked about, you know, half their citizens live in flatted properties. Enforcement is extremely difficult. Behavioural change is extremely difficult. The cost of educating people is extremely difficult if we're going to get the behavioural change that we actually want long term. And they've said they're putting huge amounts of money in, but they're still not able to reach recycling targets, and they need additional resources. So I know it's a framework bill. We know there's going to be co-design. We know there's going to be secondary legislation, but will the government make a commitment up front that if your partners in local government, through Verity House, whatever, go down this road, they will be funded? Because they're quite reluctant to go down this road, local authorities, if they think they won't be resourced to do it. And it's one thing to say that it's up to them to do this or up to them to do that, but they can't do it if they haven't got the money. And that's why they want a commitment from the government that they will be funded. And realistic funding, not kind of airy-fairy, you'll collect 100% of fines when that's never happened and never will happen. It has to be realistic. And that's our concerns about the financial memorandum, whether it's realistic. And the evidence we have at the moment suggests that there are elements in that which are not realistic, such as the examples I've given already.
Thank you, Convener. Convener, you'll understand, and I know the members will understand, that as a framework bill, this sets out strategic intentions and strategic actions, and therefore the costs in the financial memorandum are also at that level. At the detailed level of policy implementation, there will be another full set of business regulatory impact assessments around that for Parliament to scrutinise, but because those are part of co-development processes. From what the Convener is saying, I think maybe some of the concern is specifically around the code for local authorities and the household requirements. That seems to be what you were alluding to. On paragraph 48 of the financial memorandum, there is an indicative cost given there of £88.4 million, which is an estimate that Zero Waste Scotland has put in, has created, and the paragraph details how that estimate was reached, which would bring all of our local authorities to align with the existing code of practice, for example. So that is a reasonable indicative figure of what investment is required in Scotland in order to move us substantially in this direction. I think that that's quite a good indicative figure. £88.4 million is, you know, is comparable to the £70 million that we've invested through the Recycling Improvement Fund, and then, you know, and the difference there then divided through local authorities is a, you know, a relatively modest amount for local authorities. So you can see that the level of investment is proportionate to the kind of changes that we are looking for.
Okay, I'll move on a wee bit from that to the co-design area, because I mean, you've emphasised a number of times the importance of co-design, and I've already pointed out that that the local government is keen on the co-design element of it, but there still are one or two issues in relation to that. So, for example, Charlie Devine of Dundee said, and I quote, "I think that co-design at this level would be really difficult and it would probably lengthen the process considerably. Co-design can be as big and as complicated as you want to make it, and there is a real fear that what will happen is that we'll be still discussing the secondary legislation co-design many, many months in the future." And as Kirsten Maguire of South Lanarkshire said, quote, "It's pretty difficult to attribute costs. We don't have a full picture. We do not know what the secondary legislation will like, what form of the legislation will take, or what form the EPR scheme will take." So even with co-design, there's considerable concerns, actually, that that we could be down a kind of a rabbit hole with no clear ending. So when will the co-design process be concluded, or when would you like to conclude that, in order that we can actually get some of the kind of positive aspects of what this bill is intended to achieve up and running? Is it the earliest possible opportunity?
Thank you, Convener. So this bill brings forward, I think I've just counted, 11 provisions, and each one of those would have, several of those have underneath them provisions for bringing policy forward. So there will be separate co-design processes for different elements. For example, under the single-use charges, the initial policy that we're looking to bring forward there is a charge for single-use cups. So that development process, that process for developing that with businesses, householders and local authorities is a separate process from the process for developing, for example, a common code of practice for local authorities and waste, which is separate to, you know, that would be separate to developing targets, or indeed separate to developing the reporting for waste and so on. So this bill does have many provisions. There isn't going to be one single co-design process. As we bring forward each of these policies under this bill, then they will have their own timescale. These, I believe, would be enumerated in more detail in the routes map, but maybe one of my colleagues can elaborate on that. Routes map?
On the co-design timing in particular, and the comment from Dundee Council about the fear that they'll still be discussing it for years, it's helpful for the committee to know that sort of two stages to the co-design. The first one is to agree with local authorities and other stakeholders how we will deliver the co-design. That part of the process we're looking at concluding in the first half of 2024. The intention would be that that will set parameters for the co-design that follows, so that we avoid a co-design process that doesn't have a definite end to it, so that we can provide local authorities and other stakeholders with certainty about the timeline that will take. The co-design itself for the new household code of practice, that's looking at taking approximately a year, but it will depend on the outcome of determining the co-design process with local authorities and stakeholders before we can say roughly how long that will be.
Okay, and one of the issues that also came up from in questioning from myself by Dundee was regarding co-design, not just between local authorities and the Scottish Government, but they also said it's also about co-designing with the market. So how would that work?
So I can give an example of a provision which that would be the case, which is on the reporting of waste and surplus goods, because that is looking at putting a burden on businesses to report on their waste, an obligation to report on their waste and surpluses, that would need to be developed with businesses. That particular provision, for example, is already undertaken voluntarily by many businesses, including Tesco, Hovis, Unilever and IKEA. So there is already a kind of industry examples of good practice where large businesses do report on their waste and surplus. Tesco has certainly called for all businesses in their industry to do the same. So by engaging with those businesses that already undertake this work and discuss, you know, engaging with other businesses in the space, we can develop what we think is industry best practice to support these. So that is part of the process for bringing forward that particular provision reporting on waste. But of course, I'm happy to dive into any of the other provisions the convener is interested in.
Okay, well, one thing you mentioned in your opening speech was about the £1.2 billion expected to be brought in through EPR. But a concern that came up from our witnesses was how that would be distributed to local authorities. So, for example, that's a UK provision. So how would Scottish local authorities gain from that? What would be the mechanism? Because obviously one of the things you want to know is certainty about that for forward planning purposes.
Absolutely. So extended producer responsibility for packaging, which I'm afraid does not roll beautifully off the tongue, but is actually a groundbreaking provision being brought in, as you say, convener, correctly, at the UK level, is a polluter pays scheme. So the idea at the simplest level is that all producers of packaging will pay fees to a scheme administrator. Now, that will be a UK-wide scheme administrator. They will pay fees to the scheme administrator, who will then take those fees and allocate them to local authorities all over the UK so that those local authorities can run efficient and effective household packaging collection services. Now, these are matters that are still very much in discussion. What I have been pushing for, and I understand that the discussions are going well, is that that process of allocation needs to be transparent. It needs to take into account the geographic nature of regions, for example, the additional challenges that lower density population regions, islands and rural areas have, needs to be taken into account, so that each council is getting a fair allocation of that. And my understanding of the process so far is that has been accepted by the four nations, and that the allocation of that funding will go directly from the scheme administrator to local authorities. That is my understanding of the state of those discussions, that is the case. I'm, of course, very keen that that money is additional money, and that is the conversations I've had with my ministerial counterparts in the UK and the other nations, because, of course, if we are asking councils to do more, they need that additionality so that they can implement that.
Yeah, and I mean, I think that would be very helpful. I think that's something that they would look forward to providing, is indeed additionality. I mean, when we go back to the financial memorandum, though, local authorities are still expressing some concerns. So, for example, Charlie Devine of Dundee said, we need a lot more information. It says the financial memorandum is really helpful because it gives us much more scope, but we have to think. But at the moment, it's not the finished article that we could give to Parliament to consider. And Kirsten McGuire backed that up, saying there's too much uncertainty and there's not enough detail behind things at the moment. So I think when it comes to framework bills, when we're trying to scrutinise, we're trying to work with what we actually have in front of us, which is a financial memorandum, as are local authorities. But the problem we have is, and you're not the only minister to come before us with a framework bill, is that we just see the can being kicked down the road a wee bit. I mean, co-design and secondary legislation sounds great on paper, but if a local authority is looking to invest in recycling facilities, for example, you know, they need to know when to do that. They need to know what they're going to be recycling, when, what's going to be included, what's not going to be included. If they're going to have to enforce legislation, they need to be able to plan ahead in terms of how they're going to be able to fund that. And the difficulty they have is that with this financial memorandum does not appear to actually do that. So, for example, Chris McGuire says, again, quite a bit is missing from the costs we are looking at in terms of, for example, another aspect is communication, what local authorities have to spend to communicate these changes to the people living in their areas.
Thank you, convener. I mean, this bill is certainly looking ahead. It in no way are we standing still at the moment. Local authorities are doing a lot of work. There is a voluntary code of practice in place for Scottish local authorities. Every local authority has signed up to that to reach a certain standard of recycling. But at present, only one third of local authorities are actually adhering to that standard. So our local authorities are already on a journey. They already have a sort of a destination that they are looking for. What this bill puts in place is provisions for the next step beyond that again. So local authorities do know where they're going in terms of meeting that existing code of practice. They've got the Recycling Improvement Fund, which nearly all local authorities have had money about. So they are working very hard to move towards that. So this bill is the very early days of looking ahead at the next stage, at bringing recycling and waste management and resource management in Scotland up to a more European standard, more in line with what Wales is doing. So councils, they do know where they are in the near term, and this is just the starting line for how we get to that next step. And that's why this co-design is so important, because, I mean, all all of that stuff with this bill, we'll be able to start and get into those detailed conversations so that each of the specific provisions, whether that's charging for coffee cups, whether that's implementing new powers for enforcement around littering, means that the councils will have each of those as they come forward. I understand the challenge that the committee has in scrutinising a bill that has so many provisions in it, of course, and I'm happy to dive into any particular provision that the convener would like to look at.
Thank you. I'm going to let colleagues in a wee minute. Well, just one thing to... You've said that, they know basically where they're going, but they've said they don't know where they're going. I mean, so, for example, Jim Jack of West Lothian said, I'm concerned about the future, what the journey will continue to look like for waste services, our ability to be light enough on our feet, and whether we'll be funded to achieve what we need to achieve. So they don't actually feel as if they know where they're going. And Kirsten Maguire said of South Lanarkshire, until we know what our service will look like, we will not know what we're applying for funding for. So they're in a kind of cleft stick in that they're actually looking for additional resources to deliver this bill, but they're not really sure, because it seems to be a movable feast what they're actually applying for money for. And Kirsty Maguire also said that if glass had been included in the scheme, there would have been an opportunity for us to make some efficiencies, because glass is about 60% of the material we collect in our container bin, which is for glass, plastics and cans. So a lot of them obviously had been geared up with regard to the deposit return scheme. That's obviously been changed significantly. So. I have to say that although you're telling us that things seem to be going well, we're not really receiving that in terms of the witnesses that are actually giving us feedback through our scrutiny.
I understand that, Convener. Moving toward the existing code of practice is absolutely a journey that councils have been on. And looking ahead, we absolutely need to go through that co-design process. It's one of the challenges of co-design that one has to wait for the outcome of that process. Within the financial memorandum, we've given some illustrative examples of where we'd like to start with the single-use coffee cup charge, with looking at food waste in particular and food reporting, and where we know that that is the provision that we intend to work with initially. We have provided funding around those initiatives. I guess the open question is, after those initial initiatives, how would all of us collectively like to move forward? After food waste is reported on, what other sectors are interested in? I know members in Parliament have talked to me about textile waste and construction waste and so on. And these are all things that we could then take forward after we've looked, after we've done that. So we've presented within the financial memorandum all the information we have, both about how we're going to start this journey strategically and then specific provisions where we already know them.
I mean, we've got a piece of legislation. I think we'll want to move forward on it. But some of the local authorities are a bit more cautious than others, I would suggest. So one of the things that have been emphasised is, should one size fit all? And if one size doesn't fit all, how do you ensure that we don't move at the pace of the slowest caravan and we do actually get some of the changes that we want to see?
We do have a great disparity at the minute between how our local authorities implement recycling. Some of our local authorities are excellent and have very high recycling rates. Some have lesser for a whole variety of reasons. Part of the provisions, and I think, again, the member is referring largely to the code of practice element of the bill, is to help to have that standardised experience. One of the wonderful things, for example, about Scandinavian countries is that they have very, very standardised recycling, which helps the consumer understand what it is they are to do, helps them to do the right thing. So I know in Scandinavian countries, whether you're at home, at work, or at the train station, for example, it's the same colour bin for paper, the same colour bin for plastics, the same colour bin for food waste. All of that helps, for example, with communications. It helps get that recycling level up through that standardisation. Now, that is something that we may, as part of the co-design, develop with councils, is that standard across the country, so that the user experiences it in a better way, in an easier way. And I think that's because at the moment, some councils do glass, some don't. Some councils have different colours and different symbols. And standardising that across the country, if that is what the co-design process develops, would make councils' lives easier and also open up opportunities for, perhaps bulk purchasing of bins or other savings that might be useful to councils. We just, the whole intention here of the co-design is to make life easier for councils and to have that input. We all recognise that different communities have different geographic challenges, different housing stock challenges, and that we absolutely need to take into account all of this during that co-design process, which is why that the councils absolutely need to be involved in every step of that as we go
forward. This came up, obviously, John Mason raised this issue about different coloured bins. People move from one local authority to another and they don't realise the bins have changed and all the rest of it. And you say this may develop from co-design, it may not. But it's government's role not to provide some leadership and actually say, you know, this is what we want to see Scotland look like in terms of recycling in, say, 5 years, and try and actually channel local authorities in a certain direction. Because, I mean, co-design to me sounds great, but also sounds kind of woolly. Do you know what I mean? It sounds like, you know, where are we going to end up, you know? So should the government not actually provide leadership on this? I mean, these framework bills appear to me to be something of a cop-out, frankly. We've also seen it in the National Care Service financial memorandum as well. And I think what people want to know is, when you elect a government on a manifesto, they're going to work to deliver that manifesto. You know, and it's all very cuddly having everyone in the big tent and all that, but it seems to me it just takes a lot longer to get anywhere, and you don't even know at the start of the process where you're going to end up.
Yeah, where we need to end up, and the outcomes are very clear, I think, in terms of the targets. So that's both the national targets under circular economy targets and the targets for local authorities. So I think the vision here is that we know we need to get to a certain level of reuse recycling to hit our net zero targets. Putting those targets in place and then having that co-design process to say, right, we collectively, all of us, as a nation, as local authorities, we want to achieve these things. How do we best do that? That's where the co-design piece comes in. So I think the leadership piece comes in on the targets. We know we have to hit net zero. We know that means certain recycling rates. And then it is up to us to work with councils how that's best achieved, because that does indeed look quite different in a tenement in Edinburgh than it does on a remote island.
Thank you. The first colleague to come in will be Michelle, to be followed by Liz.
Good morning. I asked a question of last week's panel, which was on a scale of 0 to 10, where 0 is no confidence and 10 is complete confidence. What number would you give in terms of confidence to this FM? So same question for you, Minister. What specific number between 0 and 10 in terms of confidence would you give this FM?
10 in this FM, because it is a strategic one. So the bill, being a framework bill, is
so
a strategic...
for the avoidance of doubt, 10, you're saying that the costs given in this FM will be the final costs to the Scottish Government and to taxpayers of implementing this?
Indeed, because it's a strategic level. So within the FM, the assumptions that are made are very clear, as well as the kind of ranges that we're looking at. Because most of the provisions of this bill are about setting up those frameworks, developing process, developing legislation, the costs there are as indicative and as accurate as we can possibly make them for those things.
You're making an argument when you say as indicative as we can make them for a framework bill. By logic, following that logic, they can't be very accurate at all, because it's a framework bill that you yourself have emphasised in the estimate. This concerns me greatly. Where we see estimates, and I appreciate the complexity, I absolutely do, but our job as a committee is just to scrutinise the FM. And in some respects, we almost need to set aside the policy and the excitement that's generated by the policy and the change. Our job is to look at the FM. And as it stands at the moment, you've already heard from the convener, concerns being expressed by our representatives last week. Indeed, in answer to that question, I think it was Kirsty Maguire from South Lanarkshire Council gave her confidence level a 4, and someone else said a 5, because they were reflecting that they don't know the final cost. So just looking at the FM, we can, as it stands, have really simply no idea as to the final costs of implementing this policy. In fact, it's fair to say in any project, you never know the final cost till it's done. That's just a statement of fact. So I'm trying to establish the confidence level, given that you and all your previous evidence to the convener has set out exactly how we cannot know and the mitigations you're going to take place with that in terms of co-design. So having explained that, how confident are you now that the FM represents a final cost to the Scottish Government and the taxpayer?
I mean, the question, I suppose, is what final the member means, because the provisions of this bill, for example, on single-use charging for single-use items, that is then an enabling power that this Parliament could use again and again and again. We don't know when the next product like a single-use vape might be invented. We don't know what that might be. That could be 30 years from now.
You're describing a benefit, not a cost.
But all of that would require development. So the costs outlined in this bill include the development of those policies, the engagement required for those policies, as well as, you know, enforcement costs down the line. Mm-hmm. So the framework bill sets in place that we can develop these things for the next single-use vapor, the thing that comes out. So there isn't a final, there isn't a day in which this will be finished. Moving to a circular economy is going to be a journey that we will always be on. What this does is takes us on the next step by creating these enabling powers. Right. And the financial memorandum puts in place or shows you the funding for this next step, which is the horizon that we can see and the step we're currently taking. Every step after that, and the details of that, will be that as each piece of regulations is brought through Parliament, they will have impact assessments that will be scrutinised as each piece goes through.
Which I think the convener also has made, that if that's going through secondary legislation and, for example, an affirmative procedure by no way could be considered scrutiny, that means automatically, even going through lead committees. For example, I had a situation with the Children's Care and Justice Bill where the recent evidence session was all about costs, because exactly the same issue had occurred. There had been a framework bill and the detail of the cost was starting to come through and was going through the Education and Young People's Committee. So what I'm trying to, I suppose I'm saying here, is I personally cannot have any confidence in the FM when we have fully disclosed estimates that are quite vague because of where you are in the process, and I understand why that is the case, and we have witnesses from local councils saying, well, actually, frankly, we don't know. Then we've got mitigations in there, some ranges seven times higher. And just to frame it out, imagine if you were going to build your own house and you went to the bank and said, I think I want to borrow 250,000, but actually might be 1.75 million. And I'll let you know once I've been through all the various stages. The bank would say, I don't think so. They would be looking for considerably more detail. So why, given that tightness, when we've got critical fiscal constraints, do you think it's acceptable for us as a finance committee to sign off on an FM where, frankly, we have no clue? And that, setting aside the policy, I'm just talking about the financial scrutiny element. We have no clue, and I personally find it extremely difficult to have the right level of confidence because there's so many variances. Seven times variance in some ranges is unbelievable.
So this is the challenge around a framework bill, that we're putting in place the structures and taking that initial step of enabling powers. We're not detailing within this bill how those might be used. That will go through secondary legislation, as the member rightly points out. I mean, I myself have been involved in secondary legislation through committee recently that generated quite substantial debate, even using a negative procedure. That was... I spent quite a lengthy session in front of the committee answering questions about that. It also then went for discussion in the chamber as well. So depending on how members interact with that secondary legislation, there can be extensive scrutiny of that if members of Parliament decide that that is needed. So those powers are there as these will be brought forward. And I've got a list in front of me. For example, restrictions on unsold goods will come through the Parliament on an affirmative procedure and so on. So that there... Each piece of this will then have its chance to be scrutinised.
But as not by the Finance Committee. We are gathered as MSPs because I think it's fair to say all of us have some background or experience in finance. And it's, you know, I don't think any of us would claim to be experts. We have some experience, you know, and we've been selected to represent that. Once it's out into general committees, we lose that. So I suppose going back to following on then, that if we are now agreed that given it's a framework bill, we can't have the confidence we need in the FM, but there will be further scrutiny, do you then share my concerns that the further scrutiny will be much wider. Secondary legislation, by its very definition, will not focus exclusively on the costs, although they may be involved in that. And do you then have any worries that actually it will lead to less control over costs as we go through the parliamentary processes?
No, I don't have worry that that leads to less control over costs. I think that it leads to a more specific and detailed certainty around those costs. Because if I was to set out now, for example, what we think we would do for something that's, you know, 5 years down the road, then you would be right to say, do you know what, I don't think you can stand up to those numbers. But as this bill sort of puts us across the starting line, then we can take each project, for example, single-use cups, and dial into that and look at exactly what those costs are going to be. Now, because we'll be co-developing those, the costs will emerge as different options emerge. For example, we all know, have experience of the plastic bag charge. Now, the way that that has been implemented is for businesses alone to do that isn't something the local authorities are involved in implementing, and businesses can recoup their full cost that they feel that they need to do from that charge, and then they give the rest away according to the rules of that. That is an example of a version of that implementation that has almost no cost to local authorities on that, because the cost has been managed in a specific way. But you could have implemented that charge in a totally different way. You could have implemented it such that there were costs. So as we develop these policies, there are substantially different options on the table, hence the range. And that is why we, you know, when we go through that co-design process, it may be that local authorities will say, yes, we want to be involved in this one, we will incur costs. Or they may say, no, let's leave that one with business, and that's where the costs will be. So if I were to specify, that's where the inaccuracy would come in. What I need to be accurate and say, look, these are the strategic costs to put in place this strategic bill, and we will get into the specific costs of each policy at the at the correct time.
And I understand that. I mean, it's basically a phasing approach, and I've seen that a multitude of times in my previous life, and I understand how that works. But again, I return to the point, this is a Finance Committee. After you're away today, that's it. It's away from the Finance Committee, unless we ask you as a committee to come back with an updated financial memorandum. That's it, away from the Finance Committee, who has responsibility for ensuring that the costs are understood. So just to follow on that, given that we agree you're taking a phasing approach, have you, or how many meetings have you had with the Deputy First Minister to outline that actually as we go through year on year, we don't know, and nor can we have any proper sense of what the costs are until we reach that point. So does she know, in her capacity as Finance Secretary as well as Deputy First Minister, that actually year on year for the next few years, she has no idea about the costs of this bill? Oh, and we can add that to the National Care Service and the Children's Care and Justice Bill. Because if I were her, I'd be quite nervous about that. Because if I were in charge of controlling the costs, I want to know what's coming down the track or have a good sense of them. So how many meetings have you had with her?
I have not had a meeting on that subject. Of course, all the paperwork, including the financial memorandum, are, you know, shared with ministerial colleagues so that they can see what is coming down the line. Because this is a process of development, each of those specific costs for any particular policy will come down the way and will be scrutinised at the appropriate time and following the appropriate process. But as I keep coming back to this example of the charging for this single-use cups, because we have this excellent example of the plastic bag charge. Yeah. That is the kind of provision that we're looking at here. And that charge, it doesn't incur costs for local authorities except around some enforcement. The actual implementation, it sits with businesses who are allowed to recoup the cost from that. Yeah. So there's a whole there's everything from, you know, capital investment through things like the Recycling Improvement Fund, which of course is part of budget negotiations, and all the way down to measures that can be implemented substantially out with government expenditure. Yeah. So because of that range, because this bill covers that range, it needs to be each of those pieces that is brought in for scrutiny, and that of course is exactly the process that will be followed.
I absolutely understand that. You're describing an enabling bill, you've used the term framework bill and strategic level costs. I get all of that. Last wee question is, how do you know that we're going to get value for money?
From this bill?
From this FM.
I think the reason that we know that there's value for money here is because of the opportunities that are being unlocked. Mm-hmm. We know at the moment, I mean, just to give some examples, that contamination of our waste stream costs local authorities money. We know that litter on the streets costs them collection charges. We know that businesses are producing perfectly good goods that are going straight to landfill and incineration. During a cost of living crisis, we know that perfectly good food is being sent to incineration and landfill instead of getting into people's mouths. And there's some really good examples here. I think one of the numbers that I've got is that, you know, for every 1% we invest in enforcement around a food waste, every £1 we invest in reducing food waste, we get £250 worth of benefit for our local communities. And that means because we're not only preventing that waste for the businesses involved, but we're making sure that that product, that perfectly good food that maybe had a bad label put on it or something, is getting into hungry mouths. So the benefits to not only reaching net zero, but to making sure that goods and within our society, materials actually get used, especially by people who need them, is an immeasurable good. And I'm so glad that we're able to bring this forward.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Just to say that the saving from cups is estimated at £453,000 a year. I mean, compared to the overall cost of this, I think that's a relatively modest figure. Liz, to be followed by Ross.
Thank you. Morning, Minister. May I follow on from Michelle Thompson's line of questioning, which I think is very important. Can I just read to you what Standing Order says about a financial memorandum? That it must set out the best estimates of the cost savings and changes to revenues to which the provisions of the bill would give rise, and an indication of the margins of uncertainty in such estimates. The financial memorandum must also include best estimates of the timescales over which such cost savings and changes to revenues would be expected to rise. Can I just ask you, you've put on record this morning that you think this financial memorandum is 10 out of 10 when it comes to confidence. Are you absolutely confident in relation to the timescales that you're setting out that that is correct?
I mean, it's correct with the best estimates and the best information that we've got. I mean, the assumptions in the financial memorandum are spelled out. We are providing the committee with the best information that we can possibly have available.
I'm asking the question, Minister, because Mr. Quayle, when he answered the question about some detail about the possible timescales, there is a big question about the ongoing co-design of the policies. And it is very clear from the evidence that we've taken so far that local authorities are not at all confident that the extent of the co-design is either certain or, in terms of the timescales, is very clear. So can I ask again, why do you have 10 out of 10 confidence in this financial memorandum?
Because the financial memorandum sets out how we are going to do these things. For example, as my colleague has said, as Alex has said, that the first step to the co-design process is to agree what that process is. So, you know, we know that process is going to take some time. It'll be working with local authorities. This is all set out in good faith that we are providing the best information that we can, that we have at this moment. So I am certain that we are providing you with the best information that we've got at this time.
Well, with respect, Minister, I think just to put it out in good faith isn't enough. As Michelle Thompson has rightly said, it is our duty and responsibility in this committee to be very rigorous in the scrutiny that we adopt on a financial memorandum. And we have seen, she cited two other bills in this Parliament, the National Care Service and the Children the Justice Bill, where the co-design process, which I can understand why it's important that good policy making is based on co-design with the stakeholders, are obviously working in collaboration with the government. I absolutely get that. But if that co-design process is extended almost indefinitely, as far as I can see in this case, then it is almost impossible for us to scrutinise the final numbers of a financial memorandum. Do you accept that?
I absolutely accept that we are all looking at, you know, what the best numbers that we can with the information that we have available to us now. And I know that that information is the best information that we can provide you now. Yes, if situations change in the future, as Michelle Thompson has said, the committee is obviously welcome to invite me back, and I would be happy to give an updated, financial memorandum and to look at that if the situation changes further down the line. This is our best information that we have now, so that's of course what I'm providing to the committee. The memorandum is clear about what assumptions are involved in that, and the co-design process does mean that the outcomes of that will be developed through the process. That is exactly what a co-design should do.
So why is it, Minister, that if you're making the point that you have 10 out of 10 commitment on the confidence, that the witnesses from whom we've taken evidence are saying 4 or 5. Why is there that discrepancy? What has gone wrong there?
I think the discrepancy is understanding what the difference is between a framework bill is and the provisions that will then follow on from that framework.
Sorry, do they not understand that this is a framework bill?
Well, I think that a lot of people want to know what then, they're looking at the detail of the policy. For example, what exactly are we looking at the code of practice for local authorities? What exactly are we expecting from local authorities in terms of targets? Which single-use items and how will those charges look? So we don't have that information. That is part of the co-development process to get there. No. So when people are saying, I'm uncertain about this, I would interpret that as meaning they want to know the detail of exactly what the code of practice will look like. I want to know that too, but that will be the outcome of that co-design process.
But the logic, Minister, of what you're saying is if you have 10 out of 10 confidence in this, you feel that that degree of certainty and clarity is there. We have witnesses who are saying that that is not the case. What I'm asking is why you think there is this discrepancy in the degree of confidence in the financial memorandum, because that is a very serious concern to this committee, because it's our job to scrutinise that. And therefore, can I ask again, mm-hmm. why you think there is that discrepancy?
As I've said, I am confident that the financial memorandum lays out the strategic costs as it intends to do. Where there may be some uncertainty is where people want to know the detailed costs of the following on Precisely. Secondary legislation, which, of course, we don't have that information because that has yet to be developed. So if there is that discrepancy, it's because I would assume local authorities and businesses and so on are looking for the detail which will come with that secondary legislation, right. but is not part of this bill.
My final point, Minister, is do you accept that because that detail is not there, our job is pretty well impossible?
I mean, that detail can't be there as part of a framework bill. That isn't really the nature of the enabling bill, but that detail will be presented through that secondary legislation and will undergo all that parliamentary scrutiny.
Okay, thank you. Ross, before by John.
Thanks, Convener. Just like to return to the issues that were brought up initially by the Convener around the Recycle and Improvement Fund and what's going to be expected by local authorities through the Code of Practice. So some of the local authorities made the point that about 2/3 of the Improvement Fund has already been distributed, but they obviously don't yet know what requirements are going to be placed on them through the Code of Practice. So I wonder if you could speak to that a little bit, Minister, about what conditions government has attached to the Improvement Fund and how you expect the eventual Code of Practice to reflect the priorities that have already been set through distributing a not insignificant amount of money already.
Absolutely. So we already have a voluntary code of practice for local authorities in Scotland, which every local authority in Scotland has signed up to. So that is what local authorities are working towards. And indeed, that £1 billion of money that was invested from Scottish Government to local authorities, in addition to the Recycling Improvement Fund, which is around £70 million, are working towards that voluntary code of practice. However, at this time, only about 1/3 of local authorities are keeping up with that, are complying with that voluntary code of practice. So as a direction of travel, all local authorities moving toward that code of practice, so that's a well-understood code that local authorities are moving toward, and we know that the investment has been helping local authorities in that direction. Now, that code of practice, although it is good and it is not going to enable Scotland to reach our waste targets. So there will be some need to upgrade that. So it will be the existing code of practice plus. And that plus is what this co-design process needs to involve. Now, that plus also unlocks enormous opportunities for us. For example, Textile recycling is something that most local authorities don't look at, but actually textiles are very, very valuable materials. I've been hearing from charities who work in this space where people steal textiles because they are so valuable. If this becomes part of the plus that local authorities agree on, there are some financial opportunities there, revenue-raising opportunities for councils around producing good quality textile recycling. There are also other opportunities that aren't covered in that existing code, for example, collection of pots, tubs and trays and films. These are materials that are, again, hugely valuable. If they could be collected in quantity and kept clean and sorted, there is money to be made in this. So with that plus, we'll need to come that discussion about how any additional provisions over and above the existing code of practice not only reduce litter, reduce waste, help us reach net zero, but also ensure we unlock those opportunities. Because if a council can say, I can produce X amount of this kind of recyclate, and it's going to be clean and sorted to this standard, investors will come in and they'll say, right, I'll if you can produce that reliably, I will invest in your site, which will create jobs and, you know, put in recycling plants. So those are the kind of business opportunities that we would hope to unlock with this.
So thank you for that. Is the government's position then that the money that's not yet been distributed either through the Recycle Improvement Fund or other capital investment for local authorities, that will be sufficient for the plus, the additional layer that you're talking about? The money that's been invested in so far should be sufficient to meet the existing voluntary code of practice, though obviously most local authorities are not meeting it. We'll talk about why in a moment. But the money that is still to be distributed, that will be sufficient to meet the additional, in particular infrastructure requirements on local authorities.
So we don't know what that plus looks like. That's going to be part of the co-design process. As I said earlier in this session, and I'm just trying to find it in my notes, is the section on there we go, code of practice. It is roughly proportionate. So we estimate that to bring all local authorities in line with the existing code of practice would cost about £88.4 million. That's Zero Waste Scotland's estimate. The Recycling Improvement Fund is £70 million. So they are sort of, you know, proportionate estimates, and then some of that money from local authorities' budgets themselves, which we know they allocate. So to bring us in line with the existing code of practice, the capital investment and so forth, it's broadly in line with that. So that plus is going to need more. And that's where we need to look at both the benefits from that, whatever may come after the Recycling Improvement Fund, you know, can be discussed, but also things like the extended producer responsibility for packaging, which represents another source of funding. So all the pieces of what that plus looks like, we're really at the starting point with that, both in terms of what those plus look like, what the opportunities are, and what the funding might look like.
I'd like to look specifically at the estimates around cost for local authorities around the household waste provisions. So there's a little bit of a dispute here. The financial memorandum estimates, I think, that you're reckoning is to be two full-time equivalent members of staff for enforcement per 150,000 people. Some of the local authorities have fed back, take issue both with the financial cost associated with those two FTE positions, but also that two per 150,000 ratio. What is usually the case with financial memorandums that we look at is national government has an interest in seeking to minimise costs associated with this. Local government often, if you're cynical about it, has an interest in overestimating the cost because they want to try and get their hands on as much money as possible for perfectly legitimate reasons. And it's the job of this committee to figure out who's right or where the point in the middle actually is. So could you explain in a little bit more detail the thinking behind both the cash terms estimate for two FTEs, because local authorities believe it would be more than that, but also why the two per 150,000 ratio and how you believe that balances out across local authorities ranging from high density urban areas to remote rural and island communities.
Yep, I'll start and then I'll hand over to colleagues for the detail on that. I mean, with all the enforcement provisions, there is always a discretionary element where the local authority can decide how much enforcement is appropriate for them. For example, on the household requirement space where we're looking at contamination of recyclate, what this bill does is provide local authorities with new tools, new fixed penalty notices to enable them to, you know, a tool that they asked for, you know, to enable them to help people comply with that recycling so it doesn't become contaminated. That is not only a source of revenue, but that is a choice that they can make, a business case. If they are losing money through contaminated recycle it because they either have to sort it or then pay for it to go to incineration, they may choose to up their enforcement costs. So that a lot of this is discretionary on how the local authority wishes to do that, but I'll hand over to colleagues for detail.
Specifically on the 150,000, two officers per 150,000 of the population, that was based on a best estimate because we didn't have data that was robust enough to account for regional variation on that. Those costs are Zero Waste Scotland estimates based on average local authority costs for enforcement officers, but they won't reflect the exact costs, and indeed they might not reflect those at the higher end of the range, which may be the evidence you've heard. In the development of the secondary regulation, data on costs incurred for each notice and for enforcement can be reviewed. So there's an opportunity there as well to set out the examples, typical thresholds for the penalties, and that should give a better picture of the costs to local authorities.
Right. So just to confirm, those costs are based on actually existing costs for other forms of enforcement that local authorities already carry out, and obviously it's an average, so some local authorities will spend less, some will spend more, but that's based on existing costs in similar areas of enforcement. That's what the estimate's based on.
Zero Waste Scotland estimates of average local authority costs for enforcement.
Thanks very much, very useful. Last point around this area is the point around the fixed penalty notices for littering and the point the local authorities make around cost recovery there. Their point is, I think as pointed out a few moments ago, the FM assumes 100% of fines will be paid. Some local authorities are saying it's only 10 to 15%. Again, I'm interested if you could speak to that a little bit more, but specifically what conversations you've had with local authorities about why the payment rate for the existing fixed penalty notice system is so low, because to me that seems, nobody would expect 100%, so I'd be interested in why 100% is in the FM, but 10 to 15% does seem remarkably low. Presumably there are some specific barriers in place there that government would want to help local authorities to remove.
The question I'll pass over to Alex Butler or Janet. Yeah. Thank you.
I can cover that. So just taking a step back again, this is the provision then that will establish the new civil penalty regime for littering from vehicle, which is something that has been supported for a long time by a range of stakeholders. So this will introduce again a power, further detail and subsequent regulations. So in terms of your questions, in terms of how the costs were informed, so there was a discussion with networks, including local authorities, to get a sense of costs. We did refer to that in the financial memo, but as we've noted, costs to enforcement do vary across local authorities. And again, we can't say with certainty what the number of penalties that would be issued would be, but we have given an illustrative assumption based on around 500 penalty notices being issued, taking account of what we know about historic levels of penalties for littering and the assumption that roadside litter is about 4% of tonnage. In terms of the cost then, we've given an indicative cost based on advice from at least one of our expert local authorities and our litter manager network of an average cost of dealing with the penalty. But in terms of the assumptions of would 100% of those penalties been recovered, I think going back to when we were deliberating with the financial memo, it did not feel appropriate in a sense to assume that penalty would not be paid. A penalty should be paid by the recipient, but we do recognise, and the litter and fly tipping strategy has absolutely recognised this as a really strong theme, that we know that there is strong evidence that there is barriers to effective enforcement, and that is a big focus of the new strategy that was published in June, and we have commissioned some further research with partners to understand what those barriers are. We know local authorities would suggest potentially in some areas that resource can be a constraint. We know that's obviously one of the issues in terms of having sufficient officers to actually enforce the penalties, but we'll know that's a big focus of our work through the strategy to understand what some of the barriers are to effective enforcement. So again, the purpose of this enabling provision is to respond to strong calls from stakeholders to plug a gap, to level us up with arrangements in England and Wales. We know that littering from vehicles is a problematic area, and it's very hard under the existing FPN regime to identify instigator. So this is provided a civil regime which will provide greater flexibility to effectively enforce what is currently quite a problematic area and a big gap in our enforcement. But again, we'll be continuing to work on the costings. Further discussions with the local authorities and other agencies are already underway on this and the other enforcement provisions in the bill. We have, through our strategy, now got very effective ongoing lines of engagement with local authorities and the other enforcement bodies. So these will continue to refine in terms of the detailed cost and estimates. And the other thing that we'll be doing through the strategy is, in effect, to strengthen the data around litter and fly tipping. It is a problematic area, and as our data improves, we hope, and through some of the trials on litter cam technology, for example, to get much better data on the scale of this problem as well. So except for the reasons the Minister have set out, these are our best available estimates at a point of time, and they have drawn on some engagement with some local authorities through our existing networks.
Thanks very much. Can I just check the timescale for the research that you mentioned, how that will feed into the strategy? Because the challenge that we've got is completely understand why government wouldn't want to concede that fines are not being paid. That's totally understandable. But fines are not being paid. The financial memorandum works on the assumption that they are. So what we need to take into account is, will the additional measures that you're developing, that the research will hopefully inform, that the strategy will deliver on, that will help local authorities increase the payment rate, will they be in place in time for these powers actually, these additional fixed penalty notice powers coming into place? Because if not, clearly we're definitely not going to get close to the 100% payment. So it'd be good just to understand the timescale a little bit more for that.
Certainly. Well, I'll certainly be able to come back with specific advice on the publication timeline. So that's not something I can do today, but we can come back to. But it is something that has been set in train. And I suppose the general point would be that our efforts to strengthen enforcement and support effective enforcement is going to be an ongoing process. So we can certainly, in terms of the detailed design and delivery of this provision, continue to take account of the evidence that's available to us at this moment of time. But I think it's important again to see the littering from vehicle provision in the context of the wider focus on enforcement through other bill provisions, but also through our existing strategies again, because this is again focused on primary powers. And we already have a wide range of work and train through the strategy. So absolutely, it's something that we can continue to keep the committee cited on. And perhaps worth making the point as well on the co-design methodology, we could continue to offer any further information on that. We do have a further meeting this afternoon with COSLA, SOLAS and other local authority representatives, again, to really be kick-starting that process. So I accept it's not defined for the reasons Alex have said. We are co-designing the co-design methodology, but we'll be able to provide more information as that takes shape, including the timescales.
Thanks, Arch. We've got one final question about SEPA, if there's time, convener. Thanks. Just moving from local authorities to SEPA and their enforcement on preventing destruction of unsold goods. So the range there, I think, is between about 30 and 200 grand cost for SEPA and enforcement there. What scope is there for cost recovery for SEPA? Particularly, these are, I imagine, given the discussion that's been around proportionality of enforcement there, this is primarily going to be aimed at very large businesses producing huge amounts of goods or selling huge amounts of goods and potentially destroying large amounts of their goods that they don't sell. Is there the scope for SEPA to actually be able to recover some of the costs from these businesses through financial penalties in that area?
Yeah, absolutely. In terms of how these are going to be, we can absolutely look at that. And when these provisions are being developed, we're going to be looking at what products, how many of the products, what's to be dealt with them, what businesses. Absolutely, that can be part of that conversation, is understanding what cost recovery might look like.
Excellent. Thanks very much. That's all.
Thanks. I'm just a bit astonished, actually, that the 100% collection figure should be based on the fact that people should pay fines. People shouldn't break the law in the first place either, but we have to actually deal with reality. John, to be followed by Daniel.
Thanks very much, convener. I mean, there's been quite a lot of area covered already, so I'll maybe just start off by touching on some of that. I mean, you seem to suggest that it would be financially advantageous for councils to enforce or encourage or educate and get better recycling, and that would cover their costs in some way. But the reality on the grounds is that it's not happening, certainly in parts of Glasgow. I live in the kind of Greater Easterhouse area. I think there's a mixture of things. I think some people don't know what they should put in the bins, so they put plastic bags in the blue bins, which I understand shouldn't be happening. In tenements, we only have a green bin and a blue bin, so that's either plastic, cans, paper, and the green bins, everything else. So the garden waste goes in the green bins, the food waste goes in the green bins, and the glass goes in the green bins because most people don't have cars to take it to the recycling centre. In all my experience, I have never seen a leaflet or someone coming to the door and just trying to educate or encourage. Now, I know that is happening elsewhere. We heard from West Lothian that they're doing that. They go around the doors. Maybe it's happening when I'm here, but I've certainly not seen them. Maybe they do it on Tuesdays. It just seems to me, and Glasgow's very, very tight for money. If Glasgow thought they could make money out of encouraging people to recycle better, they would. So clearly it's going to cost them a lot more money to get the recycling rates up. I mean, do you at least accept that it's not cost neutral?
Yeah, absolutely. There's going to need to be investment. I'm just having a look here at Glasgow and how much money we've got. They've had £21 million through the Recycling Improvement Fund. So, I mean, the member's absolutely correct that there needs to be especially investment in infrastructure to enable this. That's absolutely clear. That's why we have the Recycling Improvement Fund, and that's why we invested over £1 billion through the Strategic Waste Fund between 2008 and 2022. There is an interesting point, though, I think, and that is around design of recycling systems to make things easier. I know one of the recycling fund improvements in Edinburgh, because I also live in tenement land where we have big bins in the streets, is just to change the design of the bin lids to make it so that it's more obvious what type of material needs to go in. And that's something that East Lothian does. They have some very clever trucks there that when you put recycler in, it's really easy to put the right kind of recycler in and more difficult to put the wrong kind in. So these sorts of design improvements, which can be led, do make a big difference to this decontamination. So some of it is actually fairly cutting-edge research about how people interact with recycling systems. And sometimes, I mean, giving people information isn't enough. You need to make it easy for them to do the right thing. And if it's actually difficult to get your, the big black bin bag into the recycling bin, then people won't do it. They will put the recycling in properly. So a lot of what I'd like to work towards in particularly the code of practice is that common good design. So where councils across Scotland are getting good results, we can share that knowledge with other councils so that they can, we can share that knowledge and work together to have the best type of recycling that we've got. But it isn't just about investment. And that's one of the challenges that we've seen through that investment in the Strategic Waste Fund, is that it didn't, although it was over £1 billion, it didn't bring us up to the kind of recycling rates that we would have hoped so. So more is needed. And that's why some of the provisions in this bill, for example, around targets and this co-design process, which will allow that information sharing, are also needed. This isn't something you can just throw money at. It needs that design element as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's right. I mean, I fully accept that design will help. But I mean, there's an attitude among some people that, they will drop litter in the street because that's what guys do. They will not pick up their dog poo because that's what macho men don't do. They will not recycle because that's just not macho. So there's a whole kind of attitude thing there among some people. And I'm not quite sure. I don't think your design, I'm afraid, is going to tackle that. Somebody needs to go to the doors.
Things around litter, the provision for like littering from vehicles, for example, I think is a good example of tackling the kind of culture that you're looking at there. The research shows, I think it's 1 in 7 people admitted to Churchill Insurance that they had littered from vehicle. That is clearly a very high proportion of people. One of the challenges we have at the moment is that it's very difficult to actually enforce littering from vehicle provisions because the current legislation requires that you go after the vehicle owner. So this circular economy bill proposes that we change that legislation to allow a much broader enforcement of that, much more effective enforcement of that. And the intention is that would then act as a deterrent effect, because we know that if people, people get caught, and even if they're fined, a relatively small amount, that has a deterrent effect. So all of these things together, better design, more effective enforcement, will help move that dial along.
Okay, and the vehicle littering, what I was going to ask you about. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I think £68,000 per council on average. I believe that's one official. I also believe that vehicle littering is taking place every 3 seconds. Will that one person really make a difference? What about cameras? What about whatever?
Yeah, absolutely. So these are, you know, powers to allow councils more enforcement powers. It will bring us into line with what is available in England and Wales. Our councils are currently fairly limited in what they can do with littering from vehicles. This will increase that provision. You're absolutely right that it can be very difficult to identify littering from vehicles. We currently have a pilot program going on litter cam technology using cameras on the trunk road network to understand how we can identify people who are committing these sorts of offences. So absolutely, we can move that forward. There's some example we've got from Bradford Council that they installed CCTV cameras, which they cost them £16,000, and they were issued, over about 3 months, issued the same amount of penalties as what the system cost to install. So there can absolutely be advantages to councils once they have these powers to using cameras and so on to collect fines from offenders.
Okay, well, I'm afraid I remain sceptical about the 68,000, but I'll move on. Now, we talked about recycling bins being more consistent across the country, and I think particularly, I would say, in Glasgow, where there's a lot of other local authorities within very close distance, so people have family members across boundaries, and the colours of the bins are different. Now, you suggested that might be possible going forward, but we did ask Mr. Devine from Dundee about that, and he said the cost would be, his word was, considerable, which sounded a little bit scary, that if a lot of councils, like 31 councils, have to change their colour schemes, that is going to be very expensive.
So, that we haven't started that co-design process. That might be an outcome that councils decide that they would like to go for. So we would need to work. So the process for getting to something like that would be through that co-design process. Councils would need to decide that that was where they wanted to get to. And then, of course, we would have to come up with a plan for how councils would get to that point. I can't anticipate what might come out of that co-design process.
Okay, well, it probably ties in with what colleagues have said earlier about what might come down the road later on. Moving on to something else, it's under the section for disposal of unsold consumer goods in the financial memorandum. And in paragraph 12, it talks about the cost as a kind of minimum level would be 30,000 per year. But if there was a more proactive regime, it would be 200,000 a year. Now, I think most of us would quite like a proactive regime in a number of areas, which we've just been discussing. But when it comes to the financial memorandum, it's the minimum 30,000 on page 5, which is included rather than even going partway to being proactive. Why would that be?
Because these are provisions that we would probably add to over time. Initially, we would be starting. We need to still develop this process and then get it started. So yes, I can see that initially we would probably start with estimating a low enforcement levels as companies come into compliance, and then as both more items are added to the scheme and more businesses are added to the scheme as things went on in future years, you can imagine that that might increase. There is some really interesting data around this sort of provision around the reuse of items. We have, for example, in France, France has been doing this, and they've imposed restrictions on clothing, cosmetics, hygiene products, and electrical items. Amazon have got a charity which deals with these sorts of items as well, and they have delivered over 500,000 of goods worth £10 million to families in need. So part of these provisions, although, the idea is to work with businesses so that they comply, so that they comply with these. But there's an overall kind of benefit to society here of making sure not only that we're not wasting resources, valuable materials that go into these products, but that we are helping where these products are in safe and in good working order, getting to people who really need them, both during a cost of living crisis, but to do that sort of wider benefit to society rather than letting these things go to waste. So I think there is kind of a looking at in the big picture as well as understanding that this would be a provision that ramped up over time.
Well, I'm totally supportive of what you're trying to do there. So, that's absolutely great. I don't know if you know what it's cost in France, if they had to put in. And I do actually wonder if this is not a kind of thing that you need to front load it, that you would put quite a lot of money and resource in at the beginning and then get people's thinking changing, including Amazon and individuals, And then actually the costs would reduce over time, but will it not need a higher upfront cost, do you think?
I think the member is talking about costs for sort of communication and development of the process. So the costs in the financial memorandum specifically look at enforcement. But I'm sure the member is correct that in order to implement such a scheme successfully, it would need communications and so forth up front. And that would be determined by the scale of the scheme and the businesses involved.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much. And Daniel to follow by Jamie.
Thank you very much, Convener. Although I'm slightly nervous given the billing I got at the beginning, describing me as a stalwart, so I feel I've got something to live up to. I was just wondering if I could just clarify a couple of points based on the answers being given this morning. So first of all, it's correct to say that we don't know what the full cost will be because that is subject to co-design. And what's more, we don't have a detailed co-design process or timetable in place. Are both of those things correct?
There are many provisions of the bill. I assume you're referring specifically to the code of practice for local authorities, or do you mean more generally?
Well, across the full scope of the bill, we don't know what the full cost will be that derive from it because that is subject to co-design.
Well, and subject to additional provisions
That's
being
correct.
Added over many years. So once these enabling powers are in place, I mean, for example, we've discussed already the single-use vapes, how quickly, only in the last couple of years has that a new product, and that if we had these sorts of, products being developed in the future, we would then need to react to those products. So this bill would put in place our enabling powers to allow us to do these, to react to those kind of products coming up in the future, but of course we can't anticipate.
But on that narrow question, we don't know yet because we can't know yet.
Correct.
The full cost, correct. And it just to clarify, we also don't know the process that will be used to arrive at that co-design and therefore the total cost. That's not been set out yet. Is
right.
that correct?
So as an enabling bill, this just sets us at the starting line of being able to start that process.
So the plans are not yet in the public domain about how that design process works. Is that correct?
No, because as my colleague Alex has pointed
out,
the first step of the co-design is to design the co-design process.
So in a number of answers you've given, Minister, you've also said that essentially this legislation will enable Parliament to look at this, the detail of this, when it comes forward in secondary legislation. But would you also acknowledge that secondary legislation, by its very nature, is that a process by which Parliament delegates its authority and its powers to ministers, and furthermore, the secondary legislation doesn't have the same ability to scrutinise and look at detail and critically amend legislation when those are coming forward. So would you acknowledge that actually secondary legislation gives Parliament less ability to scrutinise rather than more?
It's more about, I think, a proportionate level of scrutiny. With things like, any number of single-use items, cups, vapes, plastic bags, one can imagine that requiring primary legislation for each of those individual products would not only be burdensome on parliamentary time, but would mean that we wouldn't be able to react as quickly. That would take a great deal of time, and that would mean that potential pollution, the problem, would be lasting for many years as primary legislation was brought. Having in secondary legislation allows Parliament to not only be nimble in reacting to new products that come online, but it allows the level of scrutiny, I think, that committees and members of Parliament deem
Minister,
appropriate.
Minister, in all due respect, you're here representing the government, and it's for Parliament to decide whether it's going to have sufficient level of power. And I think you're conflating Parliament and government powers. I think in terms of the nimbleness, I accept that might well enable government to be more nimble, the Scottish government, but it doesn't necessarily enable Parliament to be more nimble because Parliament, by definition, in terms of that nimbleness, has less ability to scrutinise. And indeed, part of the reason that it takes more time for primary legislation is because we may have more ability and a greater length of time to look at the detail, which secondary legislation doesn't have because, essentially, in your words, it's more nimble, but it's for government. Is that not correct?
I mean, it's the provisions of this bill enable us to start this journey of looking at all the pieces that we need to put into place. If one was to take all these pieces through primary legislation, you know, even parliamentary time, it wouldn't be proportionate to what's being brought in. We already have very good models for a lot of what's happening here. You know, we have a voluntary code of practice. Bringing into legislation a more mandatory code of practice is a sort of logical next step. Where we have in place, we are all familiar with the plastic bag charge, bringing in place a cup charge. So the level of scrutiny needs to be appropriate to the changes that are being brought, which is why those detailed things we're proposing to be as secondary legislation. Now, the scrutiny of secondary legislation can be, you know, as in-depth to some degree that committees and members wish. We've had very good recent examples of even negative statutory instruments which underwent detailed scrutiny in committee and so on.
But we can't amend. You understand that fundamental principle that we can't amend and it's a single stage process.
But they will have gone through this co-design process as well, which is going to be transparent and will have had the input from the stakeholders as part of that process.
Even on your own terms, what I struggle to understand with this, I mean, I quite agree, you don't want individual bits of legislation for individual items or processes. And I totally also understand the need for co-design. You've got to get the detail right. But what I struggle to understand with is why that co-design can't happen prior to legislation. And I think, you know, by all means, why not do that co-design and bring forward legislation in stages to deal with things in packaging them up together? For example, dealing with single-use items, putting the coffee cup measures in conjunction with measures for plastic carrier bags, and in conjunction following the consultation and co-design. And indeed, is there not a risk, given the complexity, given that what we are seeking to do is ensure that we can recoup the full costs of recycling and the waste that is incurred? Now, that is inherently complicated. If you take forward this in a piecemeal way, with legislation without the degree of interrogation, the three-stage parliamentary process, is there not a danger that we get that wrong? So just to clarify, why can't we do the co-design first, prior to legislation, and do you not accept that actually, if detail is important, is it not better to have more scrutiny rather than less?
So I think that the correct process for bringing forth legislation of this complexity is to first enable, to, as this bill does, to start that conversation. If one doesn't do that, you end up in the situation where you're asking councils and businesses to invest what is going to be a substantial amount of time to undertake to develop legislation which may never get through Parliament. It may not happen. That would be the wrong way around to do it, because you're asking to design a process that we don't even have powers to implement, and you would be sitting in a committee very much less going, you're asking councils to develop something that you don't even know you're going to have the powers to implement. So we must understand that we have these enabling powers, so we can then say to councils, right, we have the powers to implement this. You can have that certainty. Let us work on the detail together. If you had it the other way around, you could do a whole lot of work and without those powers in place. And how would you prioritise that work?
Well, only if the legislation... Well, in fact, I would say actually your answer almost demonstrates my point. Is that at the moment, we don't know how this is all going to fit together. We actually don't know whether or not the co-design might actually come forward with things that would require different powers and different abilities. So actually, the point of scrutiny is to actually look whether or not the correct powers are in place, the correct procedures, the correct fiscal measures in order to support the policy and intent and the outcomes of that legislation. The point being is that you can look at it as a discrete package. You don't make it up as you go along. And what I also just fundamentally fail to understand is why doing the co-design first, so that actually that those things can be explored, local authorities can set out what powers they need, what financial considerations they need, so that you can ensure that the legislation is in place to make sure that it works. Why not just do that co-design first, up front load it prior to bringing forward legislation? I just don't understand.
So this, with the, I think it's about 11 different provisions in this bill that I counted up this morning, each of those provisions, or many of those provisions, are going to require co-design going forward. If we were to do co-design on single-use cups, on other products that we don't even know about yet on different industries in terms of reporting, you would then have, what I think the member is trying to imagine, that we would then have primary legislation on each of these provisions going forward.
No.
Or you can't bring any legislation until you've done the co-design on all of those. And that isn't a sensible process. The sensible process is to set out what our intentions are. We have these targets to meet. We are going to enable these kinds of powers, and then we work on the detail for each of them. It's going to be, you know, in terms of we're going to get reporting on food waste, and then, you know, we've had these conversations, but members have suggested we do textiles next or construction next, so that we can then go down that path knowing how these processes work. There are, of course, examples in other countries about how these regulations might look and might be implemented. So we can give an idea today of, and I've given several examples of the kind of things that we would bring forward with the bill. The point is that you need to have this framework in place to then hang those details off of. If you did the details first, you would end up with, you know, very cumbersome, very specific primary legislation, which you then would have to do all over again for every new product that you wanted to add to that.
Right, I would suggest that it's up to the government to bring forward legislation that works, not legislation that doesn't. And I'd also direct the minister towards the official report after this, where I very clearly said that co-design could arrive at packages of measures to legislate together. So she might want to do that. Finally, is this not a bit of a Shakespeare in Love approach to government? In that film where Geoffrey Rush, his character, was frequently asked how on earth they were going to bring it off, deliver the play, and he said, I don't know, it's a mystery. Is that not a little bit the case with this, where we've got a big plan, but we don't really know how it's going to be delivered?
That's absolutely not the case. The legislation is only one piece of what we're doing here. Within the route map, our waste route map, it has all the provisions that we're looking at, and that, you know, including matters around education, including matters around design, including matters around investment, including matters around research and development. Legislation is only one part of that, and as I outlined in my opening statement, this bill is specifically narrow. It sits in a very specific place between powers that we already have devolved in Scotland to do things. For example, as far as I'm aware, we do not need any new powers to deal with a potential ban on single-use vapes. We already have those powers, for example, and powers which are absolutely not devolved. So we would not be able to bring in something like extended producer responsibility for packaging in Scotland, because that's not a devolved matter. So this bill is specifically narrow in taking powers, enabling powers to start work on legislation and provisions that fit within our devolution settlement for a very specific purpose, and that is to help us on our journey to net zero, reduce waste, and unlock these business opportunities for local authorities, but also for the business community. So these powers in this bill are to unlock those. Now, once we know what those provisions are and how we can do them, then we can target them very specifically on some very urgent matters. You know, you'll see from the financial memorandum how much handling disposable cup waste costs councils. We can all be outraged that perfectly good food and perfectly good clothing is being sent to landfill and incineration instead of to those who desperately need it. This bill unlocks us to be able to take those things forward, and it is the right and effective way to do that we unlock those, take that enabling powers, and then use them to target those specific areas of needs, you know, efficiently and nimbly and proportionately.
A stalwart indeed. We want you back. Jamie.
Thanks very much. Good morning to the Minister and to colleagues. Just very briefly before I go on to my questions, I mean, as far as I'm aware, it's not exactly a great endorsement for, you know, the powers that you believe that you may or may not have. I mean, in terms of vapes, I would hope you'd be a little bit more sure than as far as I'm aware. And also, just the points that Daniel Johnson raised and your response to them. You know, perhaps if some of that detail had been done before on DRS, we may not have seen the complete buruk that it ended up. So have lessons not been learned from that? And, you know, some of that work, some of that engagement done with stakeholders, including businesses, surely that would be of benefit. I just wanted to ask, firstly, what assessment has been done on the economic benefits of the circularity bill?
I mean, we see in front of us the financial memorandum, which outlines for each particular provision, which, you know, with the costs and the potential benefits. In terms of the sort of overall economic benefits, I can, of course, enumerate to the member about the urgency of reaching net zero, the overall intention about reducing waste in our society. So those inefficiencies where resources go
straight to... about the economic benefits.
But these are economic benefits. When a business is wasting materials, that is, of course, you know, a cost to that business. But it's also a cost to society when, as a society, we are using the planet's resources to produce goods which actually don't go to benefit anybody. So there is a larger case to be made here that by a circular economy, which is the point of this, is an economy that doesn't have waste, that is efficient, so that all of our resources are put to best use. And these provisions together, as I say, they fit within a larger scope of work with the route map work that the UK government is doing. These are all designed to improve that economic case, to reduce that inefficiency in the system.
Okay. I mean, given that you've suggested and a big picture economic benefits rather than perhaps, you know, more of a kind of financial figure in terms of it, you know, why isn't there more detail on the economic cost to businesses, particularly small businesses, in the FM?
This is exactly the point that we've been discussing, which is about the framework, for example. I mean, we look at the example of the plastic bag charge. With that charge, businesses are allowed to recoup from that charge their costs for that charge. Now, it may be that if we did a single-use cup charge, it might be managed along those lines, or it might be managed differently. So because that has not been developed yet, that to that level of detail, we don't have that information available.
But the information, you're able to say, this will have great economic wider benefits in terms of recycling, in terms of wastage, but you can't be more specific in terms of the potential cost to businesses?
Well, that's the difference between this is a strategic bill, which absolutely we're setting out our strategic intentions here to reduce waste, to improve opportunities in recycling, to be able to create jobs in that circular economy. That is absolutely our strategic intention, and this bill is a strategic one. The specific pieces of policy implementation will be part of that secondary legislation and indeed work on our route map and so forth as we go forward. So specific provisions like the reporting of waste from a specific industry, say cosmetics industry, the details of that will be developed with that industry. That's exactly the point. At this point, this is strategic level and therefore we put in strategic level implications.
Thanks for that. I mean, do you recognise, I mean, particularly given the experiences that many within the drink sector, the hospitality sector will have had with DRS, talk of we will work with these sectors, we will work with key sectors, which, you know, certainly they would argue did not happen enough in that. Do you recognise that there may be some concern that, you know, there are going to be additional costs placed on these sectors who are already recovering from, one, the pandemic, two, fallout from the DRS and the investment they had to make there. Do you recognise that there'll be concerns that this is just another open book on kind of costs that they might have to meet and something? And, you know, what confidence can you give them that actually this really is going to be of benefit to them?
I mean, that's a really good question, because a lot of the overall principle of moving to a circular economy is moving to a polluter pays model, because as previously discussed here, a lot of these materials are produced by companies that then have to be cleaned up at the expense of local authorities, whether that's sent to incineration or landfill, whether that is picked off the street as litter, that has to be handled. So as we move to a polluter pays model, for example, with the extended producer responsibility, which is a UK-wide thing, businesses will need to pay into that extended producer responsibility model so that we have the funding for local authorities to deal with
that. You can't tell them how much they're going to pay. And as I say, many have already had to pay and invest in from DRS. So, you know, you're looking to certain, some sectors are going to have to pay again the moment that you're not able to tell them what they're going to have to pay.
Because those things are being developed. So the extended producer responsibility is being developed at a UK-wide, led by the UK government, and they are engaging with businesses on how they would like to develop that scheme. Now, there is a principle that we wouldn't double charge businesses. So where businesses are, for example, once the UK-wide deposit return scheme gets going, businesses who have those sorts of packaging, they would do their consumer responsibility bit under, or producer responsibility bit under deposit return scheme, they wouldn't be double charged with EPR. And in fact, my understanding is that for some businesses, a deposit return scheme will cost them substantially less than what they might be getting charged under extended producer responsibility for packaging. So that will drive businesses to want to get the deposit return scheme up and going. This is absolutely a big shift in our society from having public funds cleaning up our environment, to making sure that private interests are also, that the polluter pays is also doing the case. But there's a big point here, which I think I'm grateful to the member for raising, and that is, this is also about incentivizing businesses to become more efficient, to choose to use packaging that is easier to recycle. At the moment, there's no sort of penalty or advantage. A business might just go, oh, well, I'll use this not very recyclable material. But once extended producer responsibility for packaging comes in, the amount of fee that they will be charged will depend on how recyclable their material is. So that will incentivize businesses to change their practices. The reporting, the provision in this bill about reporting on sectoral waste and surplus, that has been shown where businesses do that to implement them. It does help them focus on reducing waste and overall reduces their costs. So this is part of a big shift in our economy to that, both that polluter pays model, but also to efficiency savings. And we can absolutely drill down into each provision of the bill as the member wishes, so we can talk about specific ones.
I mean, I would be very interested to speak to a lot of businesses, who, many of whom, certainly in certain sectors, are struggling at the moment, and every penny counts and every pound counts. Being lectured on efficiency from the Scottish Government is going to be interesting. Can I just move very quickly, because I'm conscious of time. I was just wondering what conversations, or what role, I suppose, the Minister sees for Scottish National Investment Bank in this, in supporting perhaps some of the infrastructure work that needs to be done.
I mean, I don't have a particular vision for that at all. That is with the Scottish National Investment Bank to decide on what they are going to invest in. So I don't have a particular
Have you had any conversations with them at all?
No, I mean, they're completely independent of the Scottish Government.
Obviously, I understand that, but obviously they had a role within DRS. And public money was invested in that. At the moment, you're not aware of any projected role for them within this?
No, and nor would it be appropriate to me. In terms of the relationship between the Scottish National Investment Bank, and I believe you're alluding to Circularity Scotland, which was a private business that was between them and wasn't it, the Scottish Government was not involved in that.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Just to finish off, Minister, I know it's been a long session so far, but it's just to refer to a couple of points that you've made yourself and the evidence you've given. So, for example, you've referred in response to myself and to Ross to the £88.4 million that Zero Waste Scotland estimate the cost will be to enable all 32 Scottish local authorities to align with the existing code of practice. But with regard to that paragraph 48, the Deputy Convener asked witnesses if they were aware of any discussions between colleagues in their local authorities in Zero Waste Scotland or the Scottish Government about where the figure has come from. Has that detail been set out? And both Charlie Devine of Dundee and Kirsten Maguire of South Lanarkshire just said no. So although that figure has been set out, there doesn't seem to be any understanding from our local authority colleagues as to where that figure has come from. So I'm just wondering if you can explain how Zero Waste Scotland came up with that figure, given the fact that they don't appear to have engaged with our local authority colleagues in producing it.
Absolutely. So this was a result of work by Zero Waste Scotland, which Alex can give us some more detail on.
Yeah, engaged with local authorities on a continual basis. So their figure of 88.4 million reflects the number of households in local authorities that would need to have a change in order for all households in every local authority in Scotland to become compliant with the existing code of practice. The 88.4 million is made up of three aspects. So firstly, there's containers. So there's the bins that you would need in order to be compliant.
Yes, it was just, it wasn't about the detail of the paragraph. It was just that because we've been talking about co-design and cooperation with local authorities, it just is of concern that they seem to not be aware of where these figures came from. So there's clearly a communication issue with regard to that, I would suggest. The other thing I was going to ask about was, in terms of numbers, was the £70 million allocated for, you know, for a recycling improvement fund. We were told of that £70 million, and again, Ross referred to this fund as well, of that £70 million, £53 million has been allocated to 17 local authorities, which means 15 local authorities have not received an allocation of the remaining £17 million. But in response to John Mason, you said £21 million has been allocated to Glasgow, which is 30% of the fund for an urban area, which has got 10% of Scotland's population, roughly. So I'm just wondering if you can, you know, it means there's only, if the figures are right, only £32 million went to 16 local authorities. It does seem quite disproportionate. Is there a reason for that?
Applications to the Recycling Improvement Fund are made by local authorities. So a local authority will develop an initiative, a proposal, which comes to the board who establishes the fund, who works with the local authority to establish whether it will achieve the outcomes that we need, because nationally we need to hit our net zero targets, how feasible is the timescale, and so on. And then the board does give me advice on whether they feel that the application, the process, is one that we should award. The challenges with Glasgow, of course, is that because it's our largest city, the impact of recycling in Scotland, is largely affected by what we do in Glasgow. So basically, if we get recycling in Glasgow right, we impact our national targets. So that is why it's, of course, really important that we get recycling in Glasgow right. So the proportion of the Recycling Improvement Fund, and indeed we did have discussions around this, because I wanted to understand exactly why this was worth doing, is because it has that impact at a national level. To meet our net zero targets, we have to make sure that money is being spent most effectively to reduce our emissions and to increase our recycling, and that was the right place for it to go to achieve that result.
I mean, I commend Glasgow for their ambition in securing, 30% of the fund, but it does mean that we've only £17 million left for 15 other local authorities. So will the Scottish Government be looking to top up that fund significantly, given that other local authorities are still looking at what the impact of this legislation might be and where they need to actually spend money most to be able to deliver more efficiently and effectively their recycling targets?
I mean, we'll certainly be intending to allocate the remainder of the fund as efficiently and effectively as possible, but we would need to have discussions about what might be follow-on funding from the after.
Yeah, I'm just concerned that some local authorities may have missed the boat. Ms McVeigh, I thought you wanted to come in here on this, sorry.
Well, yes, just again to support and slightly expand on what the Minister has said there. So in terms of the Recycling Improvement Fund, again, just for clarity, the programme board that oversees that and makes recommendations includes representatives from COSLA, SOLAS, as well as Zero Waste Scotland and SEPA, Scottish Government. In terms of future, again, this comes back to the point the Minister was making earlier in terms of the co-design process with local authorities, which will seek to co-design what good looks like, as well as what's it going to deliver that, including infrastructure. So we very much see, what comes next. Potentially, the Minister has recognised the need for ongoing support, potential investment. That will be part of the considerations through the co-design process. And again, just for clarity on the Zero Waste Scotland figure, again, that is informed by Zero Waste Scotland's experience of supporting other local authorities to align with the code. So that's where they get their information from. But it is an estimate, it's a projection, it's not an exact figure.
Okay, yeah, thank you. And just lastly, Minister, you said in response, I think it was to Michelle Thoms, that you'd be happy to give an updated financial memorandum. Just, I wrote that down as a word-for-word quote. So I'm just wondering if you now believe, following this evidence session, that you should go away and update the financial memorandum as it has been presented to us.
No, I'm content with the financial memorandum that has been presented. The context of the question from Michelle Thompson, I believe, was that if there was sort of more detail, down the line as we developed, I'm always happy to come back to this committee. This is the best information that we have at this time, and but obviously I'm at the committee's disposal should you wish me to come, if the situation changes and it requires an update. But this is the best information available at this time, appropriate to the bill.
Okay, well, thank you for that clarification. I want to thank you and your colleagues for the evidence that you've given today. It's been very helpful, the committee's deliberations. We will, of course, look at this matter further and deliberate in private session in future to produce a report. In the meantime, we'll now take a short break to allow a changeover of witnesses. We'll be back at 25 past 11. Thank you. Today is an evidence session with the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance on the Budget Scotland Act 2023 Amendment Regulations 2023, and I intend to allow up to now for this evidence session. The Minister is joined today by Scottish Government officials, Craig Maidment, Senior Finance Manager, and Neil Caldwell, Corporate Treasurer. I'll welcome witnesses to the meeting, and before I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement, I'd just like to apologise that the last session overrun by more than 30 minutes. I certainly hope this one will not do likewise. So I do apologise to the Minister and his officials. And over to you, Minister, with your opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the Committee. As the committee can appreciate, we continue to face challenging economic circumstances. Continued inflationary pressures, particularly around public sector pay, are putting real pressure on the Scottish budget. Given these circumstances, tough choices have to be made around how we prioritise spending to meet these pressures and support priority areas. These challenges are not unique to the Scottish Government. Other devolved governments and departments across the UK are struggling with these same issues. The autumn budget revision reflects our response to these challenges. The funding changes increase the budget by £361.3 million. These changes include providing £265 million to local government to support pay deals, £50 million to health, £44 million to police pensions, and £30 million to the Ukrainian resettlement. To help fund these areas, it has been necessary to reprioritise budgets. The technical, Whitehall and internal transfers are presented in the document in the usual way. Some of these technical adjustments, in particular IFRS 16, get to the heart of discussions around budget presentation transparency. I welcome the dialogue the committee has recently had with my officials and the recent correspondence on this with the Deputy First Minister, and we are considering this in the context of the 2024-25 Scottish Budget. The supporting document to the autumn budget revision and the finance update prepared by my officials reflects some of these discussions and provides further background on the net changes. And on that, I'm happy to conclude and answer any questions the committee may have.
Well, thank you for that helpful, as always, opening statement, Minister. I think when we actually look at the kind of top line figures, I think what's interesting is that although the addition is around £361 million, which is about 0.6% of the total budget, once again we see considerable movement within portfolio, and I think there's a difference between, as you've said, over the years, policy, intention and delivery. So I'm just wondering, if we look, for example, at health and social care, we've seen a movement from of about £1,059.6 million into other portfolios. And there's detailed explanations, and I think I'm heartened by the kind of information the Minister and his officials tend to provide on that. I mean, compared to how it used to be, the information provided is obviously very extensive. But I'm just wondering, when we're looking at movements of such scale in year, would it not be better that these funds were baselined into the areas where they finally end up in terms of delivery? Because clearly many of these kind of movements appear to happen kind of almost on an annualised basis. And it almost seems as if when the policy intention is created, there is a real mismatch between that and ultimately delivery. So how would you comment on that?
I think, Convener, as ever, these are fair and reasonable points. I've previously set out at committee the rationale for that approach, which you touched on in your question. What I can say is, in the context of the discussions that officials have been having with the committee, we are considering how we can, and to meet the ambitions of improved transparency, we are considering these points in detail as part of our deliberations ahead of the budget for the forthcoming financial year. So that is something that is under active consideration as well, and it is also something that is taken in the context of the Verity House Agreement as well, given that, of course, there's a number of transfers that take place to local government. So this is very much a live issue with which we are giving active consideration to. Clearly, we would not want want to do anything unintentionally harm transparency, but I think the points you make are fair, and we are giving consideration of how we can do that and how that will inform the presentation of the forthcoming budget.
Transparency that you have delivered means that we're not going to spend huge amounts of time, as we would have done otherwise, asking why this amount went here and went there, because you have actually provided some detailed explanations on many of them. But there are one or two areas which still cause concern, and I'm going to ask you something again which I've asked in the past. So, for example, there's a £44 million has been provided to an additional £44 million to police pensions to help fund a gap between the budget provided at the start of the year and current forecast of costs. Now, I asked something very similar to what I'm going to ask now last year, which is that's demand-led. But surely at the beginning of the year, when you know how many police officers are likely to retire, you know, give or take a million here or there maybe, you know, there should be a much more... it shouldn't have to be that kind of divergence of some £44 million from the initial sum. And can I ask what the... how much is now paid in police pensions, because that gives a better picture of what the percentage differential might actually be.
I think it's an important point. What I would say is, firstly, as I've said previously, is that the nature of these budgets is that they are demand-led, as you highlight, and volatile, given the flexibilities that exist around retirement options. So that's why it's historically been something that we have sought to manage in year. I would note in this particular instance, it is just police pensions where a transfer is taking place. With regards to the total allocated to date for police pensions, do you have... Sorry, can you point that to me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, it's £335,400,000.
So £44 million is quite a substantial percentage of that then. So that's why one asks why that can't be envisaged at the start of the financial year, because, you know, as I said, if it was a million here or there, you might think, OK, fair enough. But it just seems a significant amount, and one would have thought that when the budget was being drawn up, that could have been predicted, and therefore we wouldn't have to have this kind of portfolio transfer that we're witnessing just now.
I think it's a fair point, and it's something that we are giving further consideration to. Clearly, these devolved pensions differ from some of the other ways in which pensions are handled through any lines, for instance. But in this case, we are seeking to manage in year. We will give further consideration and reflection how we can refine our forecasting to hopefully move to a position where we can have a number at outset much closer to outturn. But I say, given the volatile demand-led nature of these particular lines, there is a need to manage it in year. But I think the points you make are fair and reasonable, and I'm happy to give further consideration to how we can refine our forecasting in that area.
Now, I think colleagues around the table want to dig into some of the figures. I'm just going to touch on a couple of them, really, you know, especially given the fact that I kind of overdid it really in the last session, I suppose. I think so. I'll give folk a chance to claw some time back. So I mean, in Rural Affairs, Landform and Islands Action, I'm not going into that in any detail other than the fact that you said the portfolio has been reduced by £31 million as part of the budget revision, and you give some context to that. But you've also talked about, services, for example, for agricultural support being reprofiled in future years with no loss of funding. But why does that kind of change have to take place in the first place?
So this is specifically on the agricultural reform line, the £4
million.
What basically has been, there's been further development of business case and assessment of multi-year plans, and this has identified scope for reduced spend on this programme of activity within this financial year. So we have identified an opportunity for funding to be returned to the centre, and as I touched on in my opening remark, we do face an overall very challenging economic set of circumstances. Craig, I don't know if there's any more detail you want to provide overall in the portfolio.
I mean, just to make the point that's a specific £4 million reduction in the agriculture and reform programme line, and the £31 million includes additional amounts, which I can provide some detail on. So there's a few different lines to make that up. So I can touch on that. There's £6 million in that relates to Forestry and Land Scotland, where they've been able to utilise their reserves and use that funding from reserves and return that to the centre in the current year, and that will be realigned with sort of multi-year financial planning. There's demand-led elements to these savings, as the Minister's touched on, so Scottish Forestry there's a £3 million reduction in funding there because the forecasts are lower than previously anticipated. The larger amounts, there's £14 million coming out of a combination of CAP Pillar 1 and agri-environmental and agricultural reform, which again relates to funding that has been returned to the centre because forecasts are lower than previously anticipated. But there's a commitment to return those amounts back to the rural portfolio in future financial years. So it's just a profiling point.
Is there a reason why the rural portfolio doesn't get additional funding in other aspects of it, you know, rather than it being returned in future years? Why is it not just kept within the rural portfolio? Is it because of pressing needs elsewhere?
Yeah, exactly. It's to fund the kind of significant amounts that have gone to other areas as part of the budget revision.
And with regard to using reserves, we've also heard that with regard to Creative Scotland. Is it now the Scottish Government's position that as we go forward, they'll be looking at reserves across the public sector to see where they can be utilised to try and, optimise spend in the next year?
I think what you're seeing is a reflection of the very challenging fiscal environment that we're in. You made reference to Creative Scotland. We have committed to reinstate that funding in future years. And there's the broader commitment that the First Minister has made to increase spending in culture and the creative sector by £100 million over the next 5 years. But while, of course, we would not want to find ourselves in a situation as challenging as it is, we do have a priority to ensure that we are able to fully fund our priorities to meet demands that emerge in years, such as public sector pay settlements, and, of course, ensure we are in a position to balance the budget.
I mean, I find it intriguing that so many areas appear to have reserves, in the first place. I mean, has there been any assessment of what the quantity is of these reserves across the portfolios that the Scottish Government manages?
I'm not able to speak in any detail. Is there anything that you would want to come in?
I didn't know, for example, that forestry were sitting on reserves, for example. I mean, well, Creative Scotland, actually, before it was announced by the Cabinet Secretary in the Chamber. It seems a bit odd to me.
It does vary by organisation. It depends on the classification of what that organisation is, whether it can hold reserves or not. There's no, I don't have a figure off the top of my head of any total quantum of reserves.
I mean, we've spoken about local government reserves ad infinitum over the years, but it's never really been an area we've covered, I don't believe, in other areas. So it'd be quite interesting, I think, if we could have a response on what the level of reserves is across the kind of portfolios that the Scottish Government actually manages. Now, Marine Scotland, it says here, have been able to surrender, that's a disappointing word, £2 million of budget following savings exercise involving enhanced recruitment controls, maximising income, and continuing focus on delivering operational efficiencies. But I have to say, someone with two islands in the constituency and a large seaboard, there's concerns that Marine Scotland don't have enough resources to actually ensure that we are able to ensure that our fisheries are effectively and efficiently managed, and indeed that we have that conservation also is taken into account, because when there are breaches, for example, I would give her the example of the Notakes and Long constituency, Marine Scotland have to be called upon, and there's over the years there's actually been concern that there's not enough resource in Marine Scotland for that. So I'm just wondering why it's felt that £2 million should be removed.
I would just highlight as well as how that £2 million has been generated. There has been a delivery of greater income streams through higher marine licensing fees. There's also been an increased number of shared service arrangements and collaborative working as part of that range of efficiency measures. So there's been a number of ways in which that has been generated. More generally, the decisions that we're having to take as part of this budget revision process, reflecting the changes that are taking place in year, and indeed the context in which all budgetary decisions will have to be taken, not just for the Scottish Government, but for the other devolved administrations as well, is one that is incredibly challenging, indeed amongst the most challenging since the reconvening of this Parliament nearly a quarter of a century ago. So it does mean that we do have to take difficult decisions, and that is to ensure, as I said before, that we can deliver on our key priority areas and meet these demands that emerge in year, as I've touched on, and ensure that we are in a position to, again, as we consistently have previously, deliver a balanced budget.
Okay, and in terms of internal transfers and baselining, which I touched on earlier on, in paragraph 40 here, with regard to in section A5, it says the majority of internal transfers are moving budgets from the policy lead area based on policy accountability official level to appropriate delivery body, and that was what kind of thing I asked earlier on. But how do we know which ones are being transferred because of policy accountability, you know, or not? I mean, it says which are and what. It doesn't seem to say in terms of the. So it talks about. We get a list of the significant budget internal transfers between portfolios, but it doesn't say which ones are being moved because of either policy or delivery. It just says that it's one or the other and they're being moved. Would it not be more helpful if this was kind of clarified?
Combination of both at policy and delivery, as you highlight, and sometimes these areas, the distinction is perhaps not as clear. I don't know if there's anything you'd want to add, Neil, in terms of some detail.
Yeah, so in terms of the quantum of value, a lot of the delivery of the internal transfers or the budget that's moving from one area to another is because local government is the delivery body. So in almost all of those examples, you could pretty much say that local government is the delivery body, but the policy ownership, if you like, from a Scottish Government perspective, sits in another portfolio. And in those cases, it's usually health or education.
Yeah. That's why I made a reference to, in terms of our consideration of the presentation of the budget, why we have to take cognizance of Verity House as well.
Yeah, that's what I mentioned earlier on. It's important that if these are going to be regular occurrences, we should probably be baselined in to those portfolios in the first place. Now, just on the technical adjustments, I know that there's not going to be any issue with regard to the actual amount that we're able to spend in each portfolio. But what you've said is that it's likely the IFRS 16 figures will be baselined into the 24-25 budget, meaning a direct comparison to starting budgets are not possible. Now, one of the issues that the committee's been concerned about is when we have a kind of Punch and Judy show, you know, at stage one and stage three of the budget, you know, people will talk about different figures, you know, so obviously, you know, we in the SNP benches will denounce the evil Conservative government for slashing our budgets, and the Conservatives will stand up and talk about how incredibly generous that same government is by lavishing us with ever greater record sums. So would it not be easier if we were able to try and put together a more kind of, as we have asked for, figures in relation to outturns, which enable us all to be able to talk, to sing from the same hymn sheet, at least in terms of the figures we're arguing over?
Well, I very much welcome this. This is a shared endeavour to try to ensure we have as much transparency as possible, and we can have consistency of the messaging and understanding of what the numbers actually say, and a substantive debate can take place on whether or not the allocations are aligned with people's priorities. Transparency is a priority for us. The IFRS 16 issue does throw up a particular example of the challenges it can be posed in that context. I'm conscious that there's a need to ensure with transparency that we get the balance right, because an over-provision of information, while well-intentioned, can add to complexity and can make this more challenging to be understood and comprehended more widely. Similarly, insufficient information being provided clearly presents a challenge in transparency. So we're trying to ensure that we can present these figures in a way that can be intuitively and innately grasped, in a way that is fair and representative. But I do recognise there's a complexity there. I don't know if you might be able to say something just with regard to some of the particular challenges posed around the IFRS 16 technical adjustments and issues around presentation and transparency.
So there's a three-year transition period for IFRS 16, and next year is the last one. So the 24-25 budget will have the IFRS 16 figures embedded into the baselines, which means prior year figures will be restated, which means comparatives will show reductions year on year, purely because a lot of the leases which were capitalised in the balance sheet in 22-23 will be reflected in that year. So you'll have a figure, so you can see it, and we've actually put some figures in the section C of the guide to demonstrate that. So you'll see 879 million is the 22-23 impact, whereas the impact in 23-24 is 479 million. but this is just capitalising leases that were previously not capitalised under before IFRS 16 was implemented.
Okay.
So the transitional period on that means that IFRS 16 changes are covered in budgetary terms by Treasury during this transition period, but that will come to an end after 24-25.
Yeah, I think we'll maybe want to ask further questions specifically on that in the weeks and months ahead so we can get clarification on our head and indeed the wider Parliament can get a grip on what that actually means. I think that would be an important process for us. Now, in terms of capital borrowing, just my last question before opening out to colleagues, I said I wouldn't try and hog the session, as I sometimes do inadvertently. Resource borrowing costs are down, and capital borrowing costs are down. I'm just wondering how, specifically in capital borrowing costs, given that interest rates have gone up, why we've got reduced capital borrowing costs. I mean, one of the things that came out of our sustainability report was that the UK government will cut our capital allocation over the next 5 years by some 16% in real terms. So it appears to me that one would have thought that the Scottish government would seek to maximise its capital spend wherever possible, given the need to invest in physical infrastructure, digital infrastructure, etc. So why has this happened, and what's the reasoning behind the government's move on in terms of capital?
Firstly, I would want to be clear that we do seek to maximise our capital spend and realise it is fundamental to taking forward economic growth and supporting innovation and development. What our capital borrowing powers afford us is one of the limited flexibilities we have under the devolved fiscal arrangements. And decisions around capital borrowing are taken very late in the day, and that means that we can have the most up-to-date position reflecting the most recent in-year budget position. As we would recognise with capital projects, there can be slippage and delay for a range of reasons out with any individual organisations or indeed the government's control. But maybe to provide a bit more detail on some of that decision-making process, if you want to add anything, Neil.
Yeah, so on one point, to give an example of what the Minister said, a lot of the profiling does tend to be late in the year, which does explain why you can get some late material underspends late in the year. Because capital borrowing is the only flexible area, really, of the capital budget, the borrowing policy does allow for that to be reflected. So, for example, the full allowance. This is the old capital borrowing policy as per the May MTFS.
Excuse me, everyone seems to be whispering all of a sudden. I don't know if I'm the only one that notices that you're getting, it's quite difficult for everyone to hear. You know, just wondering if you can speak up, Minister, and yourself, Niall, just a wee bit.
So I was talking about the capital borrowing policy under the previous MTFS, and it's just what it's looking at is about £250 million was the fiscally sustainable level under the old fiscal framework limits. And it's designed to allow for a level of attrition. Mm. And that late underspends that do materialise. And the point the Minister makes is that if late underspends materialise and borrowing is reduced, there's no spending power lost on the assumption that borrowing can be reprofiled into future years. So the policy is designed to be flexible because it's one of the few flexibilities in the capital budget.
So it's to ensure that Scotland doesn't lose any money in terms of its expenditure overall, is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. Okay, I'm now going to open up the session to colleagues, and the first to ask questions will be returning stalwart Daniel, to be followed by John.
I'm not used to all of this lavish praise, convener. I really just want to follow up on a couple of points that were just discussed in questioning, particularly around transparency. I mean, I'm always struck by the fact that essentially the discussion and debate around budget time is always at level three and level four, and yet the actual budget bill is essentially at level one. And actually, critically, when you look at the outturn, that's by and large specified at level one. Just in terms of transparency, and I fully take on board your point around over-provision can be a problem, and I also don't want to cause officials panic about lots more work. But do you think there is a case to explore whether or not outturn could be specified at a greater level of detail? Because ultimately, I mean, I take a very basic point of principle is that when you're setting a budget, you need to look at actually how you performed against last year's budget. And if actually the importance and the level of scrutiny is really at that level three and level four, do you think there's a case to be made to looking at the degree to which we can report back at that level in terms of outturn?
I think it was a very well-crafted question because you probably anticipated many of my answers in your preamble. So certainly we wish to be able to provide as much information as possible. We have to recognise there was a need for proportionality, and I appreciate you recognising the points of the potential unintended consequences of over-provision. We are looking at other, in terms of provisions of transparency around the COFOG classifications, for example, and I'm quite keen to ensure that we are able to provide information that is as useful and information as useful as possible for Parliament and the wider public. In terms of the level of detail that we can go into, could you maybe just touch on where we are currently with our provision on outturn?
I would need to double check. So on the provisional outturn, I think it's at the high level information. I think there is, we do go into more detail in the accounts, but that's obviously prepared on a different basis. So there can be trouble comparing Scottish budgetary basis to Treasury budget basis, and that's quite an important factor, especially because the Scottish government accounts are prepared against the spring budget revision totality, and the differences there are very different to what our outturn versus budget is on a Treasury basis, which is ultimately what matters for our, what's left in the Scotland Reserve at the end of the year. I think that's the case. I would need to double-check the precise level of detail we go into the accounts, but it is at a lower level.
It would be helpful if the committee is of one mind in terms of a view as regards to what level of detail it would like to see provided. With reference to what we provide already, very happy to have that discussion and engagement.
Yeah. What I would say, just very frankly, there's the classic exchange is opposition parties, as the sort of keen convener alluded to, say you must do X, Y, and Z, and the government turn around some justification saying, well, where does it come from? But I think until you actually have that complete level of clarity about actually how things, especially at that level below level one, actually are flowing through and how they pan out, it's actually kind of difficult to have that conversation. So I just, I think it would improve the level of debate. The level you get to, I think, is for further discussion. But I just sort of make that observation. I mean, you mentioned there that I prefigured some of your response. You prefigured my next question about COFOG. So I'm glad that is continuing to be there. I think I just want to ask one last clarification question. So we just had a brief exchange there about capital borrowing regimes, and obviously in recent weeks there's been some discussion about the issuing of bonds. I think that is interesting, but I just for the sake of clarity, because I think some quarters people's minds have been racing ahead of themselves, I mean, my understanding is that would fall within the limits of the fiscal framework, and I think it's probably worth just us all being very clear that this is an extra money that can be raised. This was all within the fiscal framework and would be a source as an alternative to the other sources of capital borrowing that are available to the Scottish Government. Is that a useful clarification?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, John to follow by Liz.
Thank you, Convener. Right, just to pick up some other points, if I may. The DPLR committee raised a few points, I think three on the papers. And one, it says that Regulation 2B of the instrument amends the amount specified for the Scottish Parliament corporate body, but replaces the existing figure with the same figure. The Scottish Government advised that the insertion of an unchanged figure was unintentional, but the figure remains correct. Can you explain what that means?
Yeah, that was just highlighted to SGLD as a figure that was changing when it hadn't changed. There should have been no inclusion of that figure. It was just an error.
The commentary more than the actual figure, right, that was the problem, right? Okay, that's clarified that. I mean, just to follow up the convener's point about reserves, I mean, I actually fully agree that we should use reserves and not just leave money sitting there, but will it put more pressure on future budgets, because that will be something we can't do again?
I I think it's an important point. It's recognising that reserves are there for a purpose. It gives those particular bodies which have that facility a degree of flexibility which is commensurate with their particular roles and responsibilities. I think we do recognise, though, that in the financial situation that we find ourselves currently, there is that facility away there, a facility available there, which is allows us and assists us to manage the overall budget position. But of course, implicit in your argument, a continuous use of reserves and depleting them would clearly be a cause for concern. They're there for a purpose. There is will have been a logic and a rationale behind that facility being available. What we have set out here and some of the specific items we've discussed with an agency and its reserves are a reflection of the particular circumstances we find ourselves in presently.
Yeah, so it could, because if we take Creative Scotland and Forestry and Land Scotland as examples, they're able to top up their budget from reserves at the moment, but in future either you would have to trim their budget or find more money elsewhere to put back in.
As I made reference, of course, with Creative Scotland, we have committed to that reinstatement that we have not been able to, or funding that we have not been able to provide at the autumn budget revision.
Okay, thanks. Moving on, the Scotland Reserve, I think at the start of 22-23 was £699 million, approximately. All of that was put then into the budget, and then at the end of the year, there was still £244 million put back into the reserve. Does it make any difference if we take the whole thing out and put some back in, or just we take out the net amount at the end of the year? I mean, is that just purely a different way of doing things?
The way in terms of how the reserve operates, it's a facility to allow us to carry forward underspends from one year, financial year to the next financial year. And the nature of underspends is it can emerge very late in the day. We saw particular examples during the pandemic where there were late funding announcements and there just simply wasn't means to deliver on that expenditure prior to the 1st of April. So the reserve provides that facility. So I hope we've set out in some detail the sources of funding for the reserve. I don't know, Neil, if you want to give some more detail.
So after the fact, there's no difference. But in terms of fiscal management over the course of a year, there is a bit of a difference because by drawing the reserve down in totality, you leave the maximum space in the reserve for the end of the year. And especially as the Minister talks about during COVID, where there was really significant volumes of funding changes late in the financial year, it was important to ensure you had that full capacity there. So if you don't draw down the reserve, you're limiting your own capacity to absorb that.
Okay, fair enough. The point's made that the Ukraine resettlement costs have been more expensive in the current year than we had perhaps anticipated. Is that completely open-ended? I mean, can we not... is there still uncertainty going forward, in other words?
Well, the nature of it being a demand-led scheme, of course, we have seen a significant popularity of the super sponsor scheme in Scotland. As of early October, some 25,000 displaced people from Ukraine had arrived in the UK with sponsorship from an individual in Scotland or from the Scottish Government. 20,000 of them under the super sponsor scheme. So the additional funding takes total funding for this year up to in excess of £100 million, which combined with the funding provided last year, totals over £300 million to date. As the recent position paper published in partnership with COSLA and the Scottish Refugee Council sets out, we're now in a position of pivoting from that emergency response to a longer-term holistic approach going forward.
And what would that mean for the finances, that it's a longer-term holistic approach?
Well, we are also working with partners and we'll continue to engage with COSLA. We will, of course, continue to monitor what the situation is in year based on their understanding to date, decisions will be taken at the budget in terms of allocations for the next financial year. But we, of course, remain absolutely committed to ensuring that we support those who have come from Ukraine to Scotland.
I mean that instead of being a specific Ukraine cost in future, it would be a bit more on housing costs, a bit more on school costs, bit more on the NHS, that kind of thing?
I think there's a recognition of that need for that dedicated provision of support for people who are rebuilding their lives and providing that support around, for example, gaining employment, accessing public services, including benefits, and indeed accessing long-term housing. So we have that continued commitment, working in partnership with local government and the third sector to provide that support.
Okay, thanks. I think there was £46 million taken from the colleges and universities budget to support because of the increased teachers' pay settlement. Is that a one-off, or does that have repercussions for the future?
We are not in a position to commit to reinstating that funding. We will consider the needs of the SFC as part of the budget process, and that funding allocation will be set out as part of the budget announcement.
Okay. And finally, on Barnett consequentials, it says the guide also reports an additional £20.2 million arising from a Home Office comparability factor error. I was wondering if you could tell us what that was.
Yeah, this goes back to the spending review, I think it was at 21-22, which meant that we had been receiving a license we were due, and that is an error that's been rectified. I don't know if there's anything you want to add, Craig.
It's just in terms of the mechanics of it. So at the time the spending review is set, any increase in the Home Office department will budget in the UK will feed into our block grant. That's quite straightforward if you're in something like education or justice, where the figures used is the entirety. It's 100% comparability factor. We consider the entirety of the increase of the block of their budget, and we get a population share of that. Conversely, defence, where we have a 0% comparability factor, we get nothing. So that's quite straightforward. What you have is with the Home Office is, I think the percentage used is in the kind of, I think it was about 74.1 was a previous percentage used. So there's a degree where some of the matters are devolved. What transpired was the slightly outdated percentage had been used. I think they'd used 74.1%, should have been around 82-83%. So there was an additional amount due, which has been funded partly. I think there was an amount in the previous SBR as well as this ABR, and it will be reflected in next year's budget as well, as there's that kind of final component of the spending review period. So it's just been an error in the calculation used.
I suppose it does. That's reassuring that error has been picked up. It does kind of raise the wider question, is the UK government making more errors that we don't know about?
I mean, these checks go back and forward in terms of making sure these figures are correct, and these get highlighted and discussed at official level to make sure everything's consistent and correct.
Okay, thanks, Camille.
At least it was in our favour. List before by Jamie.
Thank you. Minister, you rightly said in your opening statement about the uplift in the teachers' pay settlement and how that is a very important and obviously understandable commitment in the financial landscape that you've got to deal with. Could I just ask for some clarification? And I refer to table A21 when you talk about gross funding changes. Can I just ask that the figures that we have in front of us here are ones that are for the 2022-23 budget commitments on that?
Yes.
Yes. And what are the implications for the next budget of obviously the uplift that teachers and indeed non-teaching staff have had that? What are the implications going forward for these pay settlements for the budget?
Obviously, we have these are settlements that have been agreed and we have committed to going forward. And with regards to future rounds of negotiation, they will, of course, take place in the usual way through the Joint Committee. But we have worked constructively to ensure we can support these pay settlements. They have, as I think the committee appreciates, necessitated taking some quite challenging decisions. But it does demonstrate the government's commitment to the teaching profession.
Yes, indeed, and I think overall we welcome that commitment. But you're right, it has led to some very difficult decisions, and obviously the potential for more difficult decisions coming down the line for the commitments for future budgets. And it's obviously a very large part of the budgetary negotiations. And I was just wondering if you feel that pressure is going to be there for the foreseeable future.
Well, I think we have sought to support public sector pay in a way that's commensurate with the scale of the challenge we're faced with the inflationary pressures. Thankfully, we have seen some signs of inflation beginning to fall, and that will clearly create a different economic and fiscal context for future rounds of negotiations. But it is I agree entirely with what is implicit in your question, Ms. Smith. This has created exceptional pressures in the year, and of course, these are pressures that have to be carried forward. And that is something that we, of course, are giving very careful consideration to in setting out our spending plans for the next financial year.
In previous committee sessions, and you know that we're doing some work about public sector reform, mm-hmm. We've discussed previous Scottish Government commitment to ensure that the size of the public sector is around roughly what it was at pre-COVID. Is that still the intention of government policy for that to be the case?
We're not taking an approach to setting exact numbers or particular targets. The clear focus is being able to deliver. We recognise a need to go and deliver services more efficiently. That means more shared services, more collaboration, working across administrative and organisational boundaries. It also means looking at the disposition of our estate as well. So all of these factors are at play. But key to that as well is actually a real focus on delivery and ensuring that our public services aren't just delivering services to meet the needs of people, but are very much focused on a preventative agenda, because I recognise the committee's interest in medium to longer term fiscal sustainability. And yes, opportunities to increase revenue, whether that be through tax or more in the medium term through economic growth, are going to be key. But we know that we cannot meet that demand simply from increased revenue alone. It has to be about looking to prevent that demand, avoiding the risk of failure demand emerging. So looking at how we reform our public services, not just to meet the fiscal challenges that we face in the here and now, but to deliver a more efficient and effective service that is focused on the preventative agenda is key. So in terms of embracing that approach, it's not one where we're sitting and, you know, set ourselves definite numbers around headcounts, but rather focused on these particular priorities and ensuring that we have a workforce that can meet that particular requirement.
Thank you. I've got two other points of clarification, if I may. There's money being taken away from the Scottish Funding Council. Can I just ask why that decision was made and where that is being reallocated?
Can you refer to the specific line?
Sorry, I don't have it in front of me. I can't remember what the actual number was. It was for the Scottish Funding Council. There was a reduction in the money that's being paid over to the Scottish Funding Council.
Was this the money for colleges?
Yes.
For education, yes. As I touched on that, sorry, in my answer to Mr. Mason, we are not in a position to commit to reinstating that money. We will assess the needs of the SFC as part of our budget setting process.
Yeah, sorry, I heard your answer. I was just asking why you made that decision.
That decision, that was to support the teachers' pay settlement.
All of it?
Yeah.
Well, the position's fully allocated in the budget revision. So by definition, everything that was returned to the centre is supporting everything else that is in the autumn budget revision. Because you'll see in the funding tables that we provided in the document, there's no unallocated funding.
In terms of the return to the centre, there is no unallocated funding, as Neil said. And that overall position is supporting everything that is set out in terms of allocations. But clearly, the majority of funding allocated within the ABR is to support local government pay, including the teachers' pay settlement.
Right. Sticking with the education and skills portfolio, am I correct in thinking that some pupil equity funding money has been returned to the centre?
There has been a reprofiling, but there is no loss of spend on the front line. It's just a reprofiling across years. I don't know, Craig, if you want.
Okay. Are you in a position to tell us about that reprofiling?
Yeah, I'm just trying to pull together the exact details on it.
Find it. Yeah, if you haven't got it to you in your fingertips, you can get back to us on that.
Yeah, I'd be happy to get back to you on it and provide some more detail. But as I would want to stress, as part of that reprofiling, is the flexibility we've given to local government. There is no loss of spend on the front line.
Fine.
So I just want to be clear on that point.
And my final question, Minister, is on the statement by the First Minister about the £300 million extra being allocated to the National Health Service, as I understand it, 3 years of £100 million in each successive budget. Are you able to say where that money's coming from?
It will be future year's budget, and it will be set out as part of the budget process. Of course, we're still in a position right now, we're still to see the autumn statement and forecasts, etc., ahead of setting our own budget, so it will be taken as part of that process overall. Was there anything you were wanting to add, Neil?
No.
Okay, Jamie, to follow by Michelle.
Thanks very much. Good morning. Oh, good afternoon now. Firstly, can I just draw attention to my register of interests as a partner in a farming business, member of NFUS, etc. The money that the convener mentioned earlier, the £31 million for rural affairs, taken out of the rural affairs budget, can I just confirm that money was ring-fenced for agricultural use, rural affairs use?
Well, in terms of the money, the savings that have been set out to support the overall fiscal position, there were particular items that we identified which are, for example, I think it was the Marine Scotland line in conversation with the convener where we looked at some of the detail. There are other areas where the overall budget has been maintained, for example, through the use of reserves. There are other areas where there's reduced forecasts associated, and then there's other areas where funding will be deferred but will be used in full for future years. I don't know, Craig, if you can provide some more just to the specific detail overall on the ring fencing point.
Yeah, I mean, the amounts surrendered aren't ring fenced, so there is ring fenced funding goes to the rural portfolio. We provide additional funding on top of that, and it's parts of those amounts that have been returned to the centre as part of the as part of this budget revision. So I think there's 14 million of the 31, which would relate to what I think sometimes grouped as ring fence funding, but that's supplemented by additional funding from the from out with the ring fence.
This money, this 31 million, is being reprioritised. Can you say where it's being reprioritised to?
As I say, the money goes to the centre, and in terms of what it has been reallocated to, that is set out within the ABR document. So, for example, there's the resource that we've touched on for local government, the £30 million support for Ukraine, but so the resource savings go to the centre and are reallocated. Is there anything you want to add, Craig?
No, just I guess the point that was made before, that all funding, or just about every... allocated as part of the revision, so it's all come into the centre and then been utilised for the pay offers for the Ukraine amounts and as the Minister touched on.
Okay, and I mean, I don't know if you're able to say what kind of internal discussions happen or consultation happen with your government colleagues about that, because obviously £31 million coming out of a rural affairs budget, money that's intended to be used for agriculture, rural communities, etc. You know, that's a significant sum that as somebody that lives in, represents as part of a rural community, you know, would be very welcome in a lot of the sectors in those areas. So how do those discussions happen?
What I'd want to say firstly is that well, there's of course a dedicated rural affairs, land reform and islands portfolio. The interests of rural affairs are supported across a range of portfolios, as we would recognise. And certainly in areas we have sought to be more effective in getting money out of the door earlier on basic payment schemes, greening advances, etc. In terms of the decision-making process, clearly when we have a set of circumstances as we have faced in this financial year and indeed in the previous financial year, we have to look for opportunities to generate efficiencies that can be returned to the centre to support the in-year fiscal position, particularly when we have emerging pressures such as in public sector pay. So while the particular example we're considering here is on regards to the Rural Affairs and Land Reform and Islands portfolio. Across government, there will be opportunities looked at for savings to be generated, and sometimes that can mean the rephasing or reprofiling of particular budget lines. And the aim of doing that is to generate that revenue internally to support the budget position in year to meet challenges. So, for example, when you have a demand-led scheme where demand is not as forecast, then that there's a source of revenue that can be redeployed. Where there is slippage, perhaps, in a capital project, again, there's that opportunity for redeployment. And that is a continuous, ongoing process as part of the in-year budget management process. If there's anything you want to add to that, Neil?
No.
This money itself, I mean, this I suppose the source, the original source, how closely is that linked to the uplift from the BBU review?
Pardon, sorry, I missed the last part you're saying.
Sorry, how is that? That's associated money coming from the uplift from the BBU review or looked into the BBU review. Would that be right? Or?
I don't think it's directly related in this case. The BBU review funding and is part of the broader ring-fenced agriculture funding. One of the things I would say is, so historically, talked about this before, but the money that is provided to, or the budget cover that is provided for the schemes that are associated with ring fencing is higher than the ring fencing threshold and has been throughout the years. So despite the reprofiling, the terms of the ring fencing have been met.
And when would you hope this money would be returned to the portfolio?
These decisions will be taken as part of the budget process.
But there is a guarantee that that money will be returned.
We have made that commitment.
Okay. Just a very quick last point. There were technical adjustments in the expenditure limit budget for rail services in relation to the sleeper service of £5 million. Can you give more details on that? And is it related to the move into public ownership?
Well, this is a technical matter. I'm going to ask Craig if he wants to come in to explain.
Yeah, I mean, that's a recurring adjustment that's happened in, I think, the last three of the last financial years, where a prepayment relating to the sleeper has been unwound. So it's more from the accounting perspective than anything else.
Right, OK. Thank you. Thanks.
OK, thank you, Michelle.
Just a couple of brief questions off the back of what's been asked earlier. Going back to the police pensions thing, I mean, Minister, you correctly said it was demand-led and it had also been more volatility. I'm just wondering, just as a... because it's piqued my interest, to what extent is that an overhang from COVID, where we saw more people choosing to retire as a realisation that there was a life out there? In other words, have you any sense on the extent to which it will continue or the extent to which it was a one-off? And you might not know the answer to that. But...
I'm not in a position to give a detailed answer, but I'll ask my officials at the SBPA to contribute towards the response of the committee to see if they can shed any light. And
the reason I'm asking is that if that looks like that, something will continue, because you're right, there is more flexibility in terms of the way in which people can take their pensions. It would be kind of useful to know that, and it doesn't just apply to the police scheme. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking across the board. Secondly thing as well, I mean, I know you've already agreed to write to us with what reserves are actually in place. It'd also be useful for me to understand the rules around agencies that are able to gather or not gather reserves, as you pointed out, and whether there is any kind of policy thinking about that. I think most of us in this committee are pretty comfortable with agencies being required to use reserves where we're there, where we've got this fiscal tightness. But I'm interested, you know, things like SNB, when it does eventually move into profit, I personally think we want them to be able to keep the reserves, because that's how we're going to get to the scale. So that would be useful, just a bit of meat on the bones for that. And the third wee point was to thank you for your contribution today. I personally want to recognise the extra effort that's gone to this, and I find it very heartening in this as a finance committee. So I know that doesn't happen very often, but thank you very much for that. And I suppose, Minister, can I ask that you speak internally to your colleagues, because our session just now contrasts with the kind of rigour and the discipline that we have with our earlier session, where we had an FM in front of us, where that was what made us run over time. That I think the committee felt we didn't have a sufficient level of rigour, given that they're estimates, and I appreciate that. But it'd be nice if we could kind of square that circle a bit from the actuals, which this represents, and I know that it can only be accurate at actuals, but we've got quite a fluid position, increasingly with FMs coming through this committee, with estimates.
Well, thank you, and I'll make sure that the points that you've highlighted are reflected in the correspondence, and I very much want to put on record my thanks to the committee for their constructive engagement, and express my thanks to officials as well for the work that's been undertaken to get us to a position where we have taken the financial update forward. This is clearly a process rather than an event, and we will always be keen for feedback to ensure that we can present information as transparently as possible. So, as I say, this is part of an ongoing discussion and a process of refinements, but I'm very grateful for the committee's input, and certainly will ensure that the points that you have highlighted with regards to financial memoranda are relayed to relevant officials and ministerial colleagues.
Thank you.
Thank you. Just one more from me, and it goes back to the issue of reserves. I mean, we know that the Scottish Reserve's about 1.1% of the budget. We know that local government is recommended that they have about 3% of their annual expenditure on reserve, although many have below that. Some have higher than that for historic reasons, you know, Shetland, for example. But what I was intrigued by is, over recent weeks is that, you know, when it was revealed that the Creative Scotland appeared to have a reserve of £17 million against a £66 million government award, which was reduced by £6.6 million. So that's about a quarter of their annual reward is kept in reserve. I'm not sure what the £6 million represents in terms of forestry, but I'm just wondering if the Scottish Government has any particular guidelines in terms of what the kind of level of reserves should be, because we are talking about dipping into these reserves, as appears to have happened, both in terms of Creative Scotland and forestry. If this is going to be ongoing, then there surely has to be a kind of set of guidelines, if there are. I'm sure there are, but I mean, it'd be interesting to see whether or not, and to hear from you what your view is of what that reserve really should be looking at. Should we be looking at, you know, I mean, if the Scotland Reserve is 1.1%, why is Creative Scotland at a 25% level of reserve relative to the award? You know, where's the kind of, what are we actually looking at? Because there has to be some level of consistency, surely, across the public sector.
Well, with your permission, Convener, what I would be happy to do, and this touches on some of the points that Mr Mason was raising as well, is to respond to these points in detail in writing,
yes,
and the chance to have further discussions with officials and look at this matter in some detail myself. I think it's an important point that the committee raises, and I think it warrants a more substantive response than something extemporised by me at this stage in the session.
Okay, I would absolutely agree with that. I'm sure colleagues would feel that would be very helpful. So I want to thank you for the evidence you've given, and we're now going to move on to agenda item 3, which involves formal consideration of the motion on the instrument. I invite the Minister to speak to and move motion S6M 10683, that the Finance and Public Administration Committee recommends that the Budget Scotland Act 2023 Amendment Regulations 2023 draft be approved. Minister?
Formally moved.
Do any members wish to speak? We have no members wish to speak, and thank you. I now put the question on the motion, which is that motion S6M 10683 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Members are all agreed. I'd like to thank the Minister and his officials for their evidence today. We will publish a short report to the Parliament setting out a decision on the draft regulations in due course. That concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which will be discussed in private, is consideration of a work programme. So we now move into private session, and I'll just have a two-minute recess while the official report and ministerial and official guests leave. Thank you.